Hey everyone, welcome back to Dialog Choices Podcast. How are you all doing today?
Wah, wah.
Would you like Andrew's to introduce yourself, Colonel?
I am Colonel RPG. I'm a very short person. And my hair is falling off.
You're so short that your example of a tall person was to draw Andrew in a Jackbox, and he's probably like the fourth tallest person in that lobby.
He's 5'11".
That's charitable.
I don't need this kind of harassment.
Yeah, Andrew was being harassed already by his microphone.
Being harassed by most things in my life, but
that's Andrew. I'm Keith. Hello.
Yeah.
I don't know. Sometimes you introduce yourself. Sometimes not. I don't know. Yeah, it's podcasts are weird. Every podcast could be someone's first podcast. In which case. You've chosen poorly. This one's trash. You chose the worst one. How could you do that?
No, this one is good.
God, this one's so bad. Why are you here?
Oh my God. You don't even know what we're going to talk about. It's so good.
No, I actually don't know what I'm going to talk about today. I've had a plan for a few episodes, but not today. Of course, we always have more questions. Also, I was wrong. Last episode wasn't controversial at all.
Of course it wasn't.
Like, it just wasn't. It was fine. There was a lot of thoughtful discussion. A lot of people said it was their favorite podcast of the series so far.
Yeah, we're getting better.
Things were just fine.
Like, Whenever people say that, it only goes downhill from there.
Yeah, fuck us, right?
So,
well, people also said that the previous episode.
And it's only gone downhill from there.
Of course, they're all different people, probably.
Exactly.
I'm not checking.
One day, they're going to all come together, and they're going to find the one penultimate.
That's not what that means.
Sure it does. Well, they'll never find the one that is the best one, because unless we stop making them, there'll never be the best one.
Penultimate just means second from last.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it meant second from first. Oops, my bad.
So that would be the second.
People always get it wrong.
Anti-penultimate.
Some people, there's also the people that get it wrong by thinking that it means like last or best without the second part. And they're double wrong.
I thought it was second from first, which is... you would imagine penultimate. It sounds like it would be. What is pen? Is pen a negative?
In English, ultimate means the best. It's kind of like the first, except it isn't. It's the last. It means the last.
Well, it means both. Ultimate means best and final.
Yeah,
final. There's two separate definitions. Like his ultimate fate or his penultimate fate. the book before the end of the trilogy.
Yeah, it's the ninth episode.
The ninth episode, his penultimate fate.
Yeah.
Fucking stupid.
I would love that if every book that was going to kill off a character called it like the penultimate.
Just foreshadow it.
Yeah, here like it comes. The penultimate chapter.
Any
this is the penultimate
now.
Chapter of Gandalf's vision. And it's like, what? Wait, what does that mean? Like, is the book ending or is he ending? What's happening? Like,
why not both?
It's so weird when they too heavily advertise that something's going to happen and just spoil the story. Like, I'm a Walking Dead viewer, like, self-hating at this point, but whatever.
R.I.P.
I watch Walking Dead and Fear the Walking Dead, and I'm so trashed that I would be watching Walking Dead World Beyond if it wasn't a fucking subscription service.
Wow.
Because instead of dealing with, like, AMC Plus or various other pluses, I just buy a season of a show and watch it. And that's just how I watch most shows. But they're like, you can only buy it on AMC Plus by watching AMC, like subscribing to AMC Plus. I'm like, I'm probably going to watch Star Trek first on NBC, whatever the fuck, first. If that isn't, or is it ABC? I forget.
All the letters, you know.
I'm in the loop of like, you have subscribed to one thing at a time and watch that show. Like Animaniacs is on Hulu, I guess.
Yep.
It's a whole process. But, no, but like I've read every Walking Dead comic and I have them all over here. And the season, the Walking Dead, the show has an issue where it's been going on for so fucking long, just like how the comic was. Because like I got most of my Walking Dead comics. I got Compendium 1, 2, and 3, which is 3/4 of the entire series in 3 books in the 15-year anniversary collection because it was a discount bundle I could get. That was the reason. But like that was 15 years of comic already, and like the show's kind of getting up there too. But like
the show started in 2010, though.
Yeah, but it's yeah, it's like 10, it's already on like 10 season 10 and whatnot. The comic, like in a comic, you just got to keep the creator around basically, and technically you don't have to do that. But the often, unless it's a superhero comic, they usually do. A lot of Western comics, they usually keep the artist and the creator around, but sometimes the artist rotates out every like 3 to 5 years to different artists sometimes.
Yeah.
If they can't keep them on hand. But like that's relatively low difficulty to keep that train going. But a show is like this massive moving parts thing of like there's a showrunner and like directors for each episode and writers and then the entire main cast, and like everyone has to like be committed to being like stuck with the show for a long time. And so if you have a show like The Walking Dead, we're like, oh man, yeah, it's doing well. Like in the opening years, you're like, oh, this, oh yeah, business is good. And like, I'm working, I've got my acting gig. This is good. I'm happy to be on a successful show because that means I'll be doing well. So what's this going to be like a Breaking Bad, like 5 seasons and then it's over, right? And then it's like, oh God, season 10, fucking kill me. Literally kill my character.
Look on the bright side. Look on bright side. At least you're not watching Supernatural.
Oh God. That never seemed appealing on any level to me.
Supernatural was probably the last television series that I watched on television, actual television, like on a television set. The first season ended, and it was right around the time I actually stopped watching television. I did it all on a computer. And I watched like for 5 seasons, I think, maybe 4. I know, I think, I think like, because Supernatural, the original sort of narrative, had a very definite ending right around season 3 or 4. That was like a very definite ending. And they got to that ending and they just kept going. And on the season after, I just noticed these guys are just going to farm the viewers, aren't they? And I just stopped watching, really. Not that I wasn't having... Well, I was going to say,
seen,
not that I
all
wasn't
I've seen
having
is the
fun.
The endless memes of people being very mad at the final season of Supernatural.
Well, I'm sure they're very mad at all the seasons. The endings are...
I've seen videos from channels I watch that just popped up and be like, oh my God, this ship was canon, but for like 3 seconds, kind of, and then they sent him to hell. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah, that's just how what happens in Supernatural. They always go to hell.
That's a real fast track of bury your gaze.
Yeah, wow.
Like,
yeah, Supernatural has a serious...
I love you. Hell.
Supernatural is the one where where it's like fairy tales in real life, right?
It's not necessarily fairy tales. It's like it's a mixture of Van Helsing with
all the things you call supernatural.
Yeah, but it's not really focused on fairy tales. It's a lot of vampires,
like
werewolves
and witches and undead.
Yeah, some ghouls here
and
there.
People coming to life and dying and coming to life, and Felicia's Day is in there somewhere.
Yeah, and there's demons. There's a lot of demons and angels and the other things that are weird.
I've heard of it getting under fire a lot for just kind of really unceremoniously killing off characters constantly.
The same characters constantly, mind
like
you. Not like Game of Thrones.
Like apparently Felicia Day was a really beloved character in that show, and then she just got like horribly murdered off camera at some point, and then just was gone until like maybe a season ago where they brought them back. But like for a long time, that was the big axe the audience ground about that, was that they just killed off this like beloved audience surrogate gay character. It's like, oh
yeah, the supporting actors just all die in general. Although there's a couple that tend to come around, but they also die a lot because it's like Dragon Ball, you know, except without the balls. It's usually but it's basically
you can only
premise.
Bring them back once unless we decide never mind.
Yeah, is it really a dragon?
dragon. I mean, but the reason why I brought up Walking Dead and then gave too much preamble and didn't explain was that because of this whole this fucking ship of Theseus problem where everyone wants to get off this fucking show. So they have to come up, figure out with like, oh God, who's going to run the show now? And who it's got to keep going. I got to keep making money. Is that season 9, from the moment it started, every single time, like, it's Rick Grimes' final season. It's like, all right, well, this is a weird way to watch a season of a show. It's just constantly being told the main character is going to be leaving the show every day. It's like, why are you doing this to us? Are you trying to, like, deaden the blow? Because everyone's going to be so mad that Rick is gone that you have to, like, preemptively foreshadow it constantly over and over again?
No, they're
experience.
They're scaring people away. People who are fan of him, they're scaring them away preemptively, so that there's not this huge like downturn in the graphs at the end of the season. So they take some point. Like
it's also a fake out.
Oh no.
They phrase it very specifically. It's Rick Grimes' final season, not Rick Grimes will die. It's not like John dies at the end or anything. So Rick Grimes, like, there's like an explosion and he falls off a bridge and everyone thinks he's dead in the entire show and will proceed forward from there on, assuming that he is dead. But then you see him like being airlifted away in a helicopter off to go on other adventures. And there's going to be a Rick Grimes movie trilogy.
So
they're going to make three Rick Grimes movies, supposedly. But
that's why they advertised it like that.
Yeah. But separate from the main, they're going to do it separately from the main cast, because then he can do it from Australia where he lives and not have to be away from his family most of the year, every year for like he's been for like the last 9 years. So like that's the gimmick, is like we can still bank on Rick Grimes. We just can't keep him with the rest of the cast filming with him all together. Rick Grimes, really, Walking Dead as a show, half the reason I watch it is just to keep up with the narrative of like how dumb its show running is. Like it's a baffling project that keeps getting weirdly worse in different ways. Like, Andrew knows this already, but I haven't said on this specific podcast, and you might not know it yet, but like there's a really dumb thing that happened that was funny and ridiculous. But like I talk often about how like one of the coolest things about Walking Dead is it skips the zombie apocalypse outbreak and just talks about the Mad Max style society that springs up afterwards and doesn't even show the outbreak. But then they made a spinoff called Fear the Walking Dead that just shows the outbreak. But then after that being kind of dumb, at least in that it kind of like contradicts some of the cool stuff about Walking Dead, the Fear the Walking Dead show went on to actually be better than Walking Dead for the few years that it was in its opening years, especially around like season like 3 or so. And then they're like, ratings aren't good enough, let's murder the show. But they didn't just murder it, they propped up its corpse like a zombie, if you will, in that they took multiple characters from Walking Dead, had them leave that show in like emotional scenes, like, oh, here we go, goodbye, I'm leaving Walking Dead. And I'm going to go walk off to a different state for some reason in the United States. And then they'll have like a double feature where it's like it's the episode where Morgan leaves The Walking Dead is airing tonight. And then immediately afterwards, it's Morgan on Fear the Walking Dead. And it's like, oh, he's on that show now, which they had to break the spine of that show to do this, because Fear the Walking Dead's timeline didn't even slightly line up with Walking Dead. So they had to like skip forward like 5 years and break the story.
I remember you, I think you had like a big spoiler cast about this when it happened.
Yeah, it's so fucking because
you explained, why you liked the fear of the Walking Dead as well. It sounded really interesting.
It's just a better show. But then they like fuck the show and they kill off all of the main characters except for like two of them, and then replace them with all new characters, including the ones from Walking Dead. And it just becomes a different show completely. And they're just like, fuck it. It'll get better ratings if Morgan's on it. It's like you motherfuckers, you could have just canceled that show and made a new show that's a spinoff for your special character that you want to make a spinoff for. But no, you had to specifically do this shit where you like actively ruin a different show by forcing a different character into it and making him the main character now. I'm like, fuck you.
All those decisions probably come from like higher ups that don't even care. They don't even know the characters. Just like, who's the?
Oh, it's all best? Cynical. Yeah, it's just somebody like pulling strings and be like, oh, this is what we'll do. And it's like, but what about the stories we're working on? Nah.
What about good things? Don't you like good things? No, I like money. Shut up.
And it was a mess because it's Fear the Walking Dead was so fast paced and like day to day in its time scale. Like it was like this season takes place over only like 3 days or whatever. And like characters are dropping like flies, and it's really like it's a vicious universe where people don't really do well. Whereas in Walking Dead, they often like have a base, and like storylines seem to take place over the course of months or years in some cases. But they had to be like, fuck it. You know that story where everyone dies all the time? We're just gonna skip forward like 5 years, and mysteriously, all the same people are still alive, and nothing happened in between. And then we're gonna kill off all the main characters in like a handful of flashbacks because we need to make Morgan the main character now. It was the most bizarre, like,
man.
like somebody pulled the brakes on the train and there's a loud squealing noise of metal. Perverse curiosity. I'm just like, what?
It sounds like
I'm just like,
so insulting.
I'm like, what the fuck are they gonna do with the show now?
Yeah, I can't really.
They've made some other very strange choices since then where I'm like, what are you doing? What is this? Why are you doing this? You could have done so many other things.
You sound like exactly how I sounded when I was like reading Bleach. Yeah. I was like, what the fuck is this? What are you doing to me? Did I hurt you?
Sometimes you just can't look away and you're like, what the fuck is happening with the show?
You need to learn how to look away, Keith. I learned how to look away.
The comic had its own flaws, but at least it was coherent.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Like, I've seen these problems from so early in the show, and I just have to see what happens next. What are they going to fuck up next?
You can wait a few years, and then you think, oh, that's right. I used to watch this show that was very long. Let me go and look at the synopsis on Wikipedia. That's what I do. That's what I did, anyway, with the Supernatural.
Yeah. There's also the mixed problem. I'm totally just a Supernatural viewer, basically.
Except
because you have the mixed problem where you're like, but I like these three characters and stuff, so you're like weirdly also sticking it out on that level. Like there's some people
that
you want to see
nice as well.
I like Carol and Daryl, and now they're the main characters, so that's kind of an upgrade.
But that's how they string you along.
Norman Reedus is a gem. Don't stop.
I don't know. The only Norman Reedus I have seen is from your let's play of that game. Yeah, from
he looks exactly the same because he's stuck with his hair for the show, so now when he's casting other things he looks like Daryl because he can't cut his hair. I'm sure
your
at least
hair
I assume
trademarked.
I at least assume he can't cut his hair because he definitely has short hair in everything before The Walking Dead and the beginning of The Walking Dead.
Did well in what is the game called
that's Death Stranding.
Yeah, that's right. He did well there. I think he was probably the best actor out of all of them. Although the guy that did...
whenever they let him act or even react to anything or do things.
His writing was very limited in a lot of...
There's so many moments where he just blankly stares at people as they talk for like 10 minutes.
I think you had a very smart insight, I felt almost at the end of the Let's Play, where he said that it seems like half of the cutscenes are written in by one team and then another half is written by the A team.
Oh, yeah. There's totally a noticeable thing about certain games where if they just like mass produce a ton of content, then a lot of that content will feel like it was like practically just made by the developer, like the developing, like the programmers and whatnot. Like they just like plugged in content on the fly, and then like Kojima with his big like director's eye and all this cinematography and cool imagery and so on, like is only going to be there for like 5 hours of the experience, and like the other 45 hours are going to be like run over there and deposit the thing, and the guy goes blah blah blah, your goal is blah blah, and then Norman Reedus stares blankly and says nothing because he's not in these he's not in these cutscenes, even though he's in these cutscenes. It's rough. If they cut it down to just the really evocative cool shit, then the game would be like a fantastic. Well, the story's a mess, but its delivery would have been so much better. Its pacing is totally fucked. That's further reinforced by the fact that the ending ends so well, like except for the plot issues. Like they deliver the ending very well, but then but then after they deliver the ending very well, they deliver it very poorly. Because for seemingly no reason, they sit you on a beach and have you just hang out as a character narrates the epilogue ending at you, and also re-explains several things that you mostly already understand after it's over, and you're just trapped there listening to the monologue and not even a real cutscene for like 20 minutes. It's like, Kojima, please, you're so good, like 20% of the time. Just delete.
That's
everything
why
else.
Editing is so important. They need an editor that cuts 80% of his writing, because the 20% is good.
Please
needs to stay there.
Please, Kojima. Yeah.
And don't make him blue. I know blue is associated with death. Don't make him blue, because that was the weirdest decision. he basically becomes blue at the end, and it looks like it's like an off-grade like they didn't even go full on with it, because it's like all black and white except his gray tones. It's not black and white, it's gray shade or gray tones or whatever, but like his gray tones are a little bit bluish, and there's a meaning behind that, but they didn't make him super blue, so that like you're left thinking, is he really blue or are my eyes just playing tricks on me? Is my television okay? What's going on? Like, it's because you could tell that the game developers were, you know, not Kojima himself, but you can tell throughout the game that there's some friction there, even though it's his studio. But I don't know. Maybe I was seeing things.
Yep.
It works, though. He makes money every time, so don't rock the boat.
I'm happy that his next game is going to be a horror game, apparently, for two reasons. One, we might just get more follow-through on how neat PT was, but also horror games aren't paced this way. Like, you can't get away with this bullshit. He can't He can't do game, surely.
Actually...
He can do whatever the hell he wants, Keith, and he will do whatever the hell he wants.
The pacing of Death Stranding placed on a horror game, I mean, not the moment-to-moment gameplay, but, like, in terms of the plot delivery, if it was the same pacing of plot delivery...
I just mean, like, how the game's 45 hours long. Like, you can't do that to a horror game,
yeah,
really.
You can't.
To some extent, they tried to do that with Alone in the Dark, which Andrew had to suffer through. Because we played Alone in the Dark 2008 or whatever has like this linear story, but then it opened much like Last of Us Part 2. It like opens up this one hub area you can navigate like non-linearly and wander around in. And for some reason they like put stuff in there that was mandatory, and you had to kind of like go. You kind of just had to go fuck off and just like complete this open world. This like micro open world for a few hours and like be a completionist about it and get a bunch of dumb shit that was just a waste of time nonsense to then continue the story. And so poor Andrew like did like a mega recording between our sessions where he just did all that so we could go back to doing real
game
the next time I came over, because you know it's like I that was back when I was driving an hour to his house to record things, so we didn't want to waste those trips on that shit.
So you just let him do it.
Yeah.
It was just easier, but God, man.
His older recording stuff was at his house.
What a pain in the ass.
The console and the setup and everything.
Yeah. It's interesting that you say, just like The Last of Us 2. I think The Last of Us 2 was really long for the story. I feel that the story was well written, but they drew out... I don't know if... Like, I don't think the scenes were over... Like, there were too many scenes. I think... It's the
I have a weird
it's a
issue
very long
where
game.
I felt the length of The Last of Us, and it was in part because I played it in like a week, so I also like play it quickly. I felt the length, but also don't want to cut anything from it.
Yeah, because that's the
I think
problem.
It's just
like
that it is factually long.
Yeah, I think it's just I made a comment at the end of your Let's Play that said the word storyboarding, and I sort of used it in reference to what I think, or I thought rather, movies are made like. And then I went and looked into what storyboarding is, and it's much more complicated than I thought it was.
Without spoiling what happens in that game, it does have like a structural choice that's integral to why it is the length it is and what's going on with that. And I feel like on some level, making the game shorter would inevitably kind of deaden that point and reduce what they were going for, because there is kind of a like this part has to be this long and this part also has to be that long for this part to like deliver the narrative it's trying to deliver. So it's kind of a mixed thing. I don't know, sometimes games just are long.
Yeah, but I think there's some parts that could be not cut.
Oh yeah,
but
I think a significant number of people literally have the comment about the game's length when they're like in the middle of the hotel. Like at the middle of the hotel level or something, like, you know, this game's kind of fucking long.
Yeah.
It might even have to do with the pacing of that specific mission and that journey of that day, more so than the actual game overall.
I did feel that there were a few places that were way too long for their own good. The flashbacks, I thought, should have been shorter. Sometimes you tell a story and the pacing itself is part of the significance of the story. Like, for example, the one of the flashbacks, no spoilers, but one of the flashbacks goes to like this place with animals. And it's a really, really long flashback. But I think it works because there's a lot of things that you look...
The museum?
No, the... With dinosaurs.
Yeah, it's a museum.
I thought it was a zoo. Oh, it's a museum. Yeah,
dinosaurs aren't real, or they're not alive.
Yeah. No, because I was thinking of the deer. I was thinking of the deer and the giraffes.
Yeah, the zoo was the first game.
That one works because over the course of the game, you're seeing other things, and then you think back to the that level. It's such a huge level, and there's things that work retroactively because it was a big level. If it's a short level, it doesn't stick in your mind as well. But there's other levels that are like the one in the when they go to a cabin in the woods. There's nothing about that. Like it's an interesting thing that sets up a character, but like there's nothing that builds on that. So it's like a free side story that is just there, and it takes up time away from the rest of the storytelling, and it sort of breaks the pacing a little bit where you're like focusing on all these characters, especially because of the break in the middle of the game, the one that you were alluding to. Because that break, you're like, you spend the second half of the game thinking about that. The whole second half is you thinking about what happened at the middle.
Yeah. Some of the flashbacks in one half of the game, the flashbacks are kind of like filling in the gaps between the two games, and in the other part of the game, the flashbacks are kind of filling in a character.
Yeah.
But they kind of do serve some purpose.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they work, but I think some things could have been sacrificed without sacrificing the overall story. And then you can make expansions like the first one did about them breaking the little, like the cars and whatnot. With the bricks and
Left Behind, the DLC for the first game,
which itself could have been a little bit longer because it really needed a longer ending. I felt that the ending of that DLC was just
no.
It's pretty quick.
No, it was good. It was a perfectly paced time. It was fine.
I felt that it didn't have the guts of the rest of the game, you know? Because the rest of the game, I think the first
last... Well, what feels weird about something like Left Behind is the same thing that feels weird about the... even going beyond storytelling stuff, is like it's like the DLCs for Resident Evil 7. It's like you have this survival horror system where it's built around a particular pacing and resource acquisition and the acquisition of new tools... and so on. Mm-hmm. and then also like your careful management of what you have and so on, and like the game having a certain length and a certain amount of threats and things that tax your resources and so on. Like there's a certain length of like the minimum is like 5 hours, but like about 10 hours is like a pretty solid normal duration for a survival horror game to make all those mechanics feel like they're paced correctly and being layered the right way. So when you have like the DLC for the special edition of Silent Hill 2 has one where you play as Maria for like an hour, and then Resident Evil 7 is full of all these little DLCs with their micro campaigns that are all themselves about an hour long, and then like Left Behind is like 2 hours long, I think, and they're just like they're too short for that genre, so all the mechanics even feel wrong, let alone any storytelling that gets done.
Oh, like, I see what you mean.
Like it's like a Metroidvania only being half an hour long. You're like, what? Like technically I unlocked new abilities that let me open doors and that I couldn't open before, but like this is like this length doesn't feel right for this genre. Like,
but when I said longer, I didn't actually mean gameplay, although
you
meant
narrative.
I felt the ending itself like it was a little bit like in the way it was predictable, it like you thought, how should I put this? Like, if you're writing an ending, in my opinion, there's things about an ending that are predictable, right? Because, you know, we all know what stories are.
Well, and especially if you're writing a prequel.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Like, huh, this character is not in the other part. I wonder what happens. Oh, look, something happened.
Yeah. But there's other parts that are not predictable. And I think if you're writing an ending that is just going to have such a predictable, situation, you really need to make the other things work for you. And they spend too much time on the thing that we all saw coming. And I don't know, either the acting didn't carry it for me, or maybe just the story didn't.
I mean,
didn't
definitely
really...
one of their goals was just to have representation. And I don't mean that in like the cynical way. I mean, like that was one of the primary things.
I mean, it's a fundamental aspect of the character.
Yeah, it's one of the primary things they wanted to establish in that story, was having a chance to show a part of that character that they just didn't have a reason to talk about in the main game necessarily. And that was setting up for the sequel too. But yeah, and writing prequels is interesting too, because like there is that issue of like, okay, here's a like there's a dynamic of like certain characters are in the thing that you're prequelizing, so we know what happens to them because their fates were in the original material. So the prequel can't, the prequel can add details to that character, but can't change their fate unless you're just going to snap the continuity in half. So you have to like add other characters and deal with and have them as a risk. And I don't know. I think about prequels a lot lately because I was like, I just finished watching two more seasons of Better Call Saul, which is a prequel to Breaking Bad. Mm-hmm. And that one specifically, it's like that the show was conceptualized as being a prequel show for Saul Goodman, a very prominent character from Breaking Bad. That's like this really skeevy lawyer character that's involved in a lot of criminal activities and is kind of like the people that people rely on to get themselves out of a bind when they're in legal trouble for stuff they totally did, because they're all criminal organizations. And then I think, I don't remember if he was in the show originally, but they added Mike, who's also in Breaking Bad. And it's like, okay, we know exactly what happens to Saul and Mike in Breaking Bad. So that limits your scope a little bit.
In the first season, Mike and his friend, I don't remember the name of his friend, they show up like for a cameo. But they're not like, I don't think they're main characters.
Yeah, it was brief at first.
Yeah.
Like these characters are like, when you add these characters, that all you can do is like give texture to their background, but you can't like, aha, like we killed Mike in Better Call Saul. What does that mean?
In a way, that limitation makes sometimes, or it's some, I haven't watched the later seasons of Better Call Saul, but in a way, like a lot of those characters sometimes just are necessarily decoration because you can't have character development. Because the thing with character development is that if you show your character that shows up in a sequel, if you show them in a different state, imagine you have a character in Breaking Bad who is I don't remember the names anymore. It's been a while. But the cop, imagine the cop, the guy, he's just, Hank. You know, he loves his job. Hank. Yeah. He loves his job. He does it for he has this high, opinion of the police and all that. And imagine you have a prequel where he's just a criminal and just, oh, fuck the police and all that. And you're like, you show him like that, but you don't need the character development in the prequel because you already know where he's going to end up. So unless it's something so drastic that you're like, how could he ever go?
I think you still need the character development. In fact, I think by and large, what Better Call Saul accomplishes is that it's like the Star Wars prequels, but good, in that... Mm. You know where Saul's going to be, and you know he's going to fall and be a way shittier person, and he's going to be okay with all these really distressing things, because like his first establishing shot in Breaking Bad is that he's so clearly used to like the idea of somebody putting a bag over his head and dragging him out into the yard and so on, and like yeah. And then he realizes midway through, like, oh, Jesse and Walter, you guys are amateurs. All right, let me tell you how to do your job, because you guys are trash at this. Like, he was such an interesting character from the first shot. So then when you introduce Jimmy McGill in Better Call Saul season one, and he's not that person in any way, except for the part where he totally is still sleep. He still totally is like somebody willing to break rules. It's interesting watching someone get there and see like the people that helped them get there and the environment and so on, and like how that character arc works, and being thoughtful about how a character gets there in the first place, which is what the show does well. But the thing I was driving at, though, is that a really interesting way to add tension to these shows, because like, yes, it's interesting on an academic level and even an emotional level, like just to watch people like change as people. When you know what's going to happen, there's not really necessarily a tension there in the normal way. But what you do is you surround them with people that you care about that aren't in Breaking Bad. And you're like, oh, no, what happens to these characters? Are they all, does he drive them all away? Do they die? What's like, that's the tension, is like there's a, you have characters like Nacho and Kim where you're like, these characters were not in Breaking Bad. And like, maybe they just never met Walter and Jesse and they're living happy lives just off camera, or maybe they're underground or I don't know, like, or maybe they had to flee to France under a new name and assume a new identity. Like, who knows what happens to them in the show? And that's like the new tension you get as a result when the show increasingly fills its roster with like, and now Gus is back and now Hank is back, like, and you're like, okay, I know what happens to these characters, but what happens to Kim? And like, it's that's like the best prequel I've ever watched. It's so good. It keeps staying good. It's a great show.
I really need to watch it, because I watched the beginning of the second season. I watched the first one,
yeah,
and then I watched the beginning of the second one. It was getting a little bit too lawyery for me, And I was like, meh.
And it's specifically good. When I say it's the best prequel I've watched, I mean specifically in that it also is very much in its DNA a prequel. Because sometimes a prequel is just a story that took place earlier. But the mechanics of being a prequel and what that means to a narrative are often kind of sidelined and not very important to the prequel itself. It's often just an excuse to tell more story in a universe or with characters that are concluded, so you can't keep adding to the end anymore. A lot of prequels aren't very interested in being prequels. And so it's just like, it's just another movie where we just kind of like, yeah, it ended, but we want to do this more. But specifically, Better Call Saul is like obsessed with how it's a prequel, and it does it so well. I don't know what something about like that. Is it Gilliam or something? Gillen?
Yeah, Gilliam. Gillum, I believe.
Gillum.
I don't remember. I know it's Gillum. Something. Gillum Anderson.
Vince Gilligan is fucking detail oriented. Whatever his system is, I want to watch every show he makes now.
He has Gillian Anderson is from, I know that's a different person altogether. He has a very long history of producing, and I think he was X-Files. He made a bunch of X-Files. That's why I remember Gillian Anderson, because she's from X-Files as well. I think, I don't remember. Let me see.
Is she the main character that you're talking about
from X-Files?
I don't know their names very well.
She's one of the main characters. There's two.
Like there's Bulk and Skull, Scully and something else.
Scully, she's Scully, yeah.
She's Scully. I can never remember what name is which, or even all their names necessarily. And also, I can't remember which one's the skeptic and which one's the person that believes everything.
None of them is skeptic.
I've watched very little X Files. I just remember a scene where they're on a bridge, and their car gets stopped, and the person that stopped them doesn't have a face. Like that's the only image I have of all of X-Files, the show. And then I watched the movie that came out like 10 years ago without any of the context of the show from before it.
I hear that movie was bad. I didn't watch it.
It's just around. I'm like, oh, X-Files. People talk about that a lot, but I've never.
I watched X-Files back when it. I watched some X-Files back when it was airing. I was a kid at the time. So like going back is a little bit of nostalgia, but also discovery. Yeah. And it's pretty fun. It's really like really well acted, and I think maybe it draws on shows that already existed, like Twilight Zone. But I didn't watch Twilight Zone, so I don't know how that compares. But yeah, Vince Gilligan started off as a creative consultant and then a producer for X-Files, and he didn't do much after that. Actually, Lone Gunman and MPED, and also Harsh Reality.
Vince Gilligan? Gillian Anderson or whatever.
No, Gillian Anderson, she does everything.
Whoever you said.
No, I'm talking about the creator of Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. Yeah.
I was going to say, he made stuff now.
Yeah,
he's making things currently. I got to get around to my giant sci-fi backlog. Because there's part of me that desperately wants to have watched every single Star Trek from front to back. And all of Twilight Zone and X-Files. But it's just so much. It's so much. And it's so easy to put off every time. It's like, all right, I just finished a season of a show. What should I watch next? And it's like, do I really want to click on Picard's face right now? Is this the mess I want to start now? Or do I want to watch like another thing in my backlog? There's always something else before I start the giant mega project nightmare.
But X-Files is not very like... like story oriented. There's some character development for sure, and there's some setup, but for the most part, it's a monster of the week show. That kind of structure. So you can like look up the most, like maybe watch the first season, like first few episodes to get yourself acclimatized, and then just watch the most well rated episodes.
This is why super fans on Reddit and stuff have designed like episode compilation, or it's like here's the correct episodes to watch to like watch this fast. Like, I think Andrew watched Doctor Who with an episode guide that tells you to watch, like, half of each season, and here's the ones to watch, and so on, so you can get through, the many seasons much faster. That's tempting, too. But, yeah, like they're making a Star Trek Picard is a thing right now, And it's like, I want to watch it because Patrick Stewart's Jean-Luc Picard is one of my favorite characters, like in fiction. And I grew up watching Next Generation and I love it. But I also like haven't watched Next Generation since I was like 13, maybe. And so I kind of want to go back and watch all of Next Generation first. But then I'm like, well, when am I going to get around to my task of wanting to watch all of the original series first? And it's like, okay, do I watch the entire original series and then the entire animated series and then watch all of Next Generation while also getting to some of the movies along the way and then watch just a Star Trek Picard? It's like, it's like, okay, I mean, I can.
No Discovery?
That's like a 500-hour project. What?
No Discovery?
Oh, I'm already watching I watched season one of Discovery already. It isn't direct continuity the way that
Yeah, it's a different. I know.
Picard is all continuity with the Next Generation show, which is one of my favorite shows, and then the movies, obviously, because those are continuity too, and like characters die and shit. And that's important. But then also, it's like, but I keep wanting to watch the original series, and it's like, am I really going to skip to Next Generation again? Because then I'm never going to watch the original series. funnily enough, Joe broke my last spree of watching Next Generation, Andrew. I think you probably already know. You might remember the story because you were there. But
probably.
I was talking about how I was watching the original series, and he just cuts me off, and he's like, I was watching an episode of original series Star Trek, and Joe was like, oh, is it the one where there's a misunderstanding? And it just like broke my will to both finish talking and also watch the show again.
Is it every episode a misunderstanding?
I mean, there's always like this is the problem, but actually this is what's really going on. It's like it's kind of a meme, but like it's also like a thing where like just because you can observe and summarize a thing doesn't diminish its quality and what's there. It's like how if you play Witcher 3. You can fall into the rhythm of like, okay, I'm going to be introduced to a scenario and someone's going to tell me what a problem is. I'm going to go to the place that the problem is and I'm going to find out, actually, there's new context that changes the original idea of what this mission's about. And like, you can start memeing on how that's like the pattern that they keep doing over and over again. And like, but like at the same time, if they didn't do that, you just have boring missions where nothing changes. And the thing is what it says on the wrapper and then you just beat it and then it's over. I think it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just very observable as a trend.
Yeah. Wasn't The Last Wish, the book, very much about that as well? Like every.
Literally the first short story of The Witcher sets the tone for all of Witcher 3 and so on, where like, hey, whoever sends you on the mission, they're lying to you. They're always lying to you about something. They're either straight up lying because they want you to kill something that doesn't need to be killed because it serves their purposes, or
it's not the right thing.
Basically. Yeah, or oftentimes they have some kind of personal stakes. That is the bias behind all this, and maybe the thing, or in many cases it's like there's a deeply personal embarrassing thing that there's a secret they don't want to get out, and so they don't tell you that part even though it's useful important information because they don't want anyone to know this big thing that either would have helped you in the investigation or is secretly the whole reason why it's happening and so on. There's always, humans are always the real monster. They're great books.
That's the subtext of
That's also a giant backlog I'm afraid of, is that The Witcher series.
You haven't read them all yet?
No, it's so long that I'm like kind of afraid. It's very easy to just hop in and read the two short story novels because each of them's like 10 little tiny chapters that each make up like a super story, and then there's like 10 of those super stories in the book, and then it's like, oh, this is very digestible and fun, and you get to see Geralt on adventures, and it still has like character arcs and development and people, like reoccurring characters that change over time. Like, it's still great storytelling, but I'm afraid of watching. I'm a little afraid of getting into the big monster, and it's like, I know it'll be good and I want to read them, but it's the same thing as Star Trek where I'm just like, yeah, but like the size of it, like when's the time?
Yeah, it's about the habit. You need to read a chapter a day before you go to bed or something.
I have this idea of like a twist where it's like, I played Witcher 3, which is the one where Geralt has his memories back, but I didn't have the memories of what he has his memories back of. But then I'm going to read the entire Witcher book series, and then I'm going to play the two games where he has amnesia, and I'll know everything that he doesn't know.
I don't think the games have a lot of stuff from from preview. The first two, I don't think the first two games have a lot of stuff.
I know that Triss is there. And yeah, like Triss I think there's the dwarf and the elf are both there that are important in the books, but
it's just
he doesn't know who they are.
Triss, there's the dwarf.
Triss
there's
has
also
like some consent problems to deal with there.
Well, throughout the trilogy as well.
Well, yeah, but just the fact that like Triss is like sleeping with him under false pretenses because she already knows who he is and things. It's like that seems concerning.
That's the whole plot of her romance in the last game.
Yeah.
Or I mean, dealing with that anyway. Yeah, there's also another. There's a doctor. I don't remember her name though, and I think she's also from the books. But yeah, there's just some characters that know The Witcher and they say, "Hey, good to see you around. What's up?" And it's like, yeah. "I lost my memory." And she's like, "Oh, okay, go kill this monster." And that's basically how it goes.
What do we want today to be? I guess we should probably talk about Among Us, huh?
Oh, Among Us.
We've all started playing Among Us lately, and we're not great at it or anything yet because we're starting out, but.
But you're better than I am because you always vote me out.
We can update our thoughts about it at least. And like its limitations and its pros and so on.
What limitations? I didn't see any limitations.
There are a lot of limitations.
I just like as a social deduction game and whatnot. Like for a pro, something that stands out to me about Among Us is just that it doesn't have the convoluted stuff that I find irritating about other hidden role games. And this is like my own bias or whatever, but like I like Resistance. And in Resistance, there is one team, and then there's the other team, and those are all of the roles. It's just what team you're on, and that's it. And much like that, Among Us is like, okay, like most people are on the good team, and there's like one or two traitor-y people, and you're trying to suss them out. And so it's simple enough that you can be like, okay, what faction are you? And try to deal with that. But like stuff like Salem and Ultimate Werewolf and probably Mafia, but I haven't played it, and like a few other things. It's like, what if there was like 10 roles? Like, what if there was literally more roles available in the game than there are players in the game? I think Trouble in Terrorist Town might be like this too, where it's like, there's a trickster and there's a martyr and there's the king and then there's like the detective and I'm like, this is so fucking convoluted that like, how do you?
That's like rooted in happening? The old school tabletop deduction games.
Like it's so convoluted that I'm like, how do you tell what's ever happening? It's like, aha, there were 17 layered lies happening based on the people, the roles that were randomly drawn in this game. And I'm like, I hate this. I hate this.
And they made that into a video game?
Town of Salem and Ultimate Werewolf, I think, are like, yeah, and Mafia. I think those are all like playable video games. And Trouble in Terrorist Town is a Gmod game that is based on these ideas. And that seems to be popular. Like and like maybe it's the thing where there's just like such a learning curve that's super off-putting, and maybe if I like really committed to it for a long time, eventually I'm like, wow, maybe this is great all of a sudden. But like I've always found there being too many roles really off-putting. I always want just like two roles, and I just want them to be, and I just want the systems around them to be interesting, like the process through which they win or lose. And in that way, like Among Us. It's like that's interesting. You're on like a ship or whatever, and one team's doing tasks that inherently. It encourage them to split up and become nice, vulnerable murder victims. And then the other person is trying to kill them without getting caught. It's like, all right, that's a good starting point. We're in a good place.
Yeah.
Straightforward. It executes on it executes that really well as being like it's like a version of Resistance where more interesting things are happening on a mechanical level besides just the lying. Because in Resistance, you just do missions and they just pass or fail based on who is on them. Have you played Resistance before?
No. All the games that you are talking about, I'm like, I am a noob.
Yeah,
if it weren't for you, I wouldn't have played Among Us even.
Resistance is a tabletop card game with hidden roles where, much like it's similar size to Among Us, where you play with like 5 to 8 people or something, and like one, like based on the player count, a certain number of them are traitors, like 1 to 3, and preferably you're playing with a lot of players. In that game, the mechanic is that. One person at the table is the captain or the team leader, and their job is to put together a team that can succeed at doing a mission. And missions succeed by you simply voting for them to succeed. Like you just like what happens is everybody who is on that mission who is selected by the team leader, which the team leader can select themselves or not select themselves, they all put in a card that's their vote for how the team, how the mission went. And then the team leader takes all those cards and shuffles them and then anonymously deals them out. And then you find out how many votes there were for pass and fail. And so if they're the spies, they'll be sabotaging the mission anonymously if they want to. They can also intentionally let it pass to remove suspicion from themselves. And so it's a best, and so it's a best of five game where whichever team, if there's three successful missions, then the resistance wins. And if there's three failed missions, then the spies win. And so every round you're like, okay, that mission one had those two, had those three people on it and it succeeded. What should I do with the second mission? Okay, the second mission, what if it has like one of the people from the first crew, but then like all new people besides that? Like, and then you start trying to build this like logic puzzle of like, okay, which people can we trust based on which missions have succeeded and which people have failed and who was on those missions each time. And so you try and deduce based on that who the spies and traitors are. And you're all very critically, you're all sitting at a table and yelling at each other.
Yeah.
So like that's the key to social deduction games. You have to be like debating and discussing these things and coming up with lies and so on. And like on that level, the debate of what happened and so on is really interesting. And the and there are mechanics though that are not in Among Us, like the fact that you can send people on missions in little crews, and that lets you section off people in a very observable way and figure out that way. But there isn't enough mechanical variety to what's happening moment to moment in that there's no circumstantial evidence. And that's where Among Us excels, is that Among Us, you're literally people navigating a map, and everyone has a story, and people have to lie.
Among Us really has to have that, because you're not at the table.
And yeah.
It depends so much, because if you're on a table, you can absolutely make your game around just the people. You're really playing the people, you're not really playing the game. But Among Us, that's not like that. You're very much playing the game, and then the playing the people sort of plays a secondary role.
Yeah, you'll do the tasks, and then it switches back and forth between like being a tabletop game and being a video game, and it's like tone, like it has the voting phase and the gameplay phase. But yeah, it leads to a situation where like you have much more complicated data where you're navigating a map, and you have the things that you saw and the things that you did, and everybody else experienced different things, and two of the people who experienced things are lying about what they experienced, and you have to like cross all these narratives under a time limit to try to get data. It's way more variety and depth on that level, and that's definitely very interesting. But yeah, but at the same time, I think one of the biggest limitations I have with that game is the fact that you can never communicate, really, as far as I can tell, or the fact that you can't talk to people, because obviously if you can talk to people, it leads to a situation where people will just shout out who the killer is when they find it, when they like they'll just react. Yeah. If we're all in comms, we'll just react to the killer, and when we react if we react to the killer, then that everyone knows who the killer is, and that fucks it all up.
It'd be an interesting mod to it probably isn't very difficult, because there must be a server. So as long as you get the info, like a mod to change the volume of like somebody in a room, in a chat room.
Oh yeah, like the game could totally use environment location, dialogue.
Yeah,
like only people right next to me can hear me, because then you can coordinate like, hey, you and me, let's stick together. Let's try going around here and doing this. It's like, oh, and I gotta do this mission, you gotta do that mission. Okay, we'll go there together and then there together, and like you can coordinate.
And it could be all the game. It doesn't need to be a mod. It's just the game.
Yeah, it could just be in the game. And then then it'd be like, haha, I was telling you that way I need to do a mission over here, but actually I'm the killer, and you kill him. and like you could use that to manipulate people, because nothing about being a killer means you can't talk. But Among Us doesn't have any of that. So there's a level of playing the actual game part that feels a little too blind and flaily. Like there's no way to communicate with people. So you can't be like, hey, let me watch me do the scanner, or hey, let's go here together. Or any communication, like you can't even communicate your intent of like, hey, let's work together, or I'm chasing to kill you. But obviously the killer would just lie, but it definitely feels like something's missing on some level. And like we didn't get to play it the correct way, but there's a game called like Unfortunate Astronauts, which itself is a bunch of unfortunate spacemen. I played that with Bird and Andrew a few months ago, but we played it with the three of us and then a bunch of randos, and like the net code was trash and the game felt like it was barely working. And so until a Mandalore video came about it recently, I had no reason to suspect it was good at all, because it was such an off-putting experience. I'm like, this doesn't seem like it could be good at all. But that one is like, you're a bunch of colored spacemen and one of you is secretly a monster that's trying to eat you. And that one does have radius voice, so you can talk to people that are near you. Mm. And it's like, maybe our crew will try that sometime as a group, and maybe that'll be good. It is free to play. But does some of those things that I find interesting that I feel like I'm missing.
When you're playing with a group of people that you know, it's just any game really can become fun.
Also, apparently, apparently in a response to Among Us's popularity, that game just added voting rounds. Because it didn't have that. It used to be that you just walked around and tried to do various tasks and it's a 3D game, 3D mm-hmm. first person shooter. You'd go around and do your tasks around the ship, and then the monster would just try to assassinate you, and you could just talk to anyone that was near you. So it was kind of like The Thing, where everyone's splitting up and you're trying to like deduce who the killer is so you can kill them in return. And then you like you shoot him and you're like, I turned into a horrible monster, and now it's a shooter where we're all shooting him before he gets us all. But now it does act, you can turn him on and off apparently, I think, but it now does have a voting round where somebody can like call a vote, and then everyone like debates who they think the killer is and votes them off and so on. Which is a clear response.
Yeah, it makes
anyway. Yeah. You guys go on about Among Us. I've talked too much this episode. I feel really guilty.
I wonder if you can turn off the guns in Unfortunate Spacemen.
So that you can only vote?
That you can only vote, which feel like would be... That would be more interesting to me, because the guns are kind of stupid, because in my head, I'm just going to shoot everybody once. Because if you do that, it's good. Like, if it's the monster, they're going to freak out and they're going to transform.
They're probably going to think you're like, the killer and then just kill you.
No, because if I shoot them, I wouldn't shoot them if I was the monster. I would just attack them in monster form. You turn into a monster and attack people. So if you just shoot somebody once, it's not going to kill them.
That it's like, the monster would never do that. Like, immediately, that's the thing the monster can do, specifically because the monster wouldn't do that.
What do you mean?
Like, nobody will think I'm the monster because the monster wouldn't shoot people. Like, okay, the whole new strat is for the monster to shoot people.
No, I'm saying I don't actually know if the monster can shoot people.
Yeah.
I don't know it's if the monster person. Can. Oh, the monster can use guns?
I'm sure they can. I mean, I don't.
I found the tutorial we played, the monster couldn't use guns.
I mean, the monster impersonates people, so there's no reason to... Otherwise, everyone could just shoot a gun at a wall, and then it's like, he's the monster, he can't use guns.
Yeah.
Like, that'd be silly. I'm sure the monster can use guns, it's just more effective to eat people.
Yeah.
There's also other stuff, hope nothing happens to me while I'm dealing with this garbage chute, and the monster can just push you in. Like there's contextual prompts where the monster can get hitman style environmental kills if you're interacting with certain things. If they sneak up on you, just push you in the garbage disposal.
I struggle a lot with social deduction games where there's things you're supposed to do in them, because I don't care about the social deduction part. That's the least fun. That's the least fun part of the game.
You just want to be efficiency boy.
I just want to do tasks and be done with it. I don't care about the social deduction game is so boring. That's
people
the
ask
most,
me what
the
tests
worst
I did.
Part of the
I'm
game
like,
to me.
I don't know what tests I did. I completed them. That's what I did.
If you're not focusing on your tasks, you're super suspicious. That's the whole reason you're playing this game. It's just to do tasks.
He's focusing on his tasks. It's just that he's kind of mindlessly chasing the yellow arrows, then just doing the thing and moving on and not committing it to memory.
Yep.
Alibis.
Yeah. I try to make sure that I pay attention to where people are. Like if I run past somebody, I'm like, oh, that's weird. I saw Colonel and Admin, and I'll keep running. But my biggest problem is I'm never with anybody. I will not run with a person. I will not watch you do anything. I'm going to do my tasks. That's why I'm here.
Yeah, I have to decide to follow you.
Yeah, and like you can tell if I'm doing my tasks because I will not. I don't care. I just keep moving. I just keep moving to do, and if you're in front of my task, I will just dance to get you away.
I'm used to this.
Just get,
Because it's because you will just play games wrong.
Like, yes, you don't but give, that's you the don't thing. It's like, I don't... Like he, like I don't, he, like I don't normally play like, games with other people. Like
he would,
so like
he would always
the...
complain that Left 4 Dead was a multiplayer game because he just wanted just wanted to run to the end of the level alone every time. It's like that's just not what this game fundamentally is.
Yeah, I just want to run through and kill zombies. Like, that's all
the game
I want.
You want is somewhere else.
That.
Go play that one. Like it exists.
I can't find it.
there's not a whole lot of good zombie shooters. To be fair.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of single player zombie shooters that aren't like survival horror. I don't want to survive in horror. I just want to kill zombies and run through.
You want a Dynasty Warriors of zombie shooters where you're just gunning them all down.
Serious Sam comes to mind.
Serious Sam is
probably
I have Serious Sam, but it's killing not I don't floor? Like it. I don't like killing
floor.
Killing
floor is third person, isn't it?
No.
Killing Floor is like a multiplayer
Killing
shooter.
Killing Floor is a wave-based shooter, which you can just play in single player if you want to.
Oh, okay.
I don't.
Kind of like Sniper Elite, but the Sniper Zombie stuff would be really awkward single player, I think, because it's just a lot of zombies that are a little too difficult to kill alone.
Yeah.
I play
a game to have fun.
We should probably wrangle up Effie and Bird and just finish that someday. Instead of leaving
zombie?
Off. Yeah, because we played it for like an hour or something. Like, maybe we should just go back and finish Zombie Trilogy. That was nice.
I think we were close to the end, weren't we?
Well, it's a trilogy. Maybe we're finishing one of the games, maybe? I don't know.
But, that's the thing. It's like, games like Among Us or Unfortunate Spaceman, for me, aren't interesting because the main mechanic they sell you on isn't what I want, and so I struggle with playing those types of games because
it's definitely an interesting take to be like, well, I don't want to play a social deduction game. I'm like, all right, well,
when I'm the imposter, I almost lose every time because I don't want to do anything but tasks. So I'm like, oh,
like the time that you were helping us fix the ship. And just sitting in the top left corner is the imposter.
Can we just do the thing? I just want to do the thing. Like, it's a task I can do. Can we do the task?
Not your task.
Like,
your task is to not have that succeed.
It's a task I can do, so it's something I want to do. I want to do something. Like, God, it's so boring being the... It's so boring being the imposter.
I love
because
being
all you
the
do,
imposter.
You just walk around, you kill a person, and then it's like, who did it? Wasn't me.
Did you guys notice me calling out Durf immediately the moment I got like super detected by Effie? I thought that was my best acting moment ever because it was because you're like
it's Durf, he's sus again, kill Durf first again.
No, because like I was trying to make that like because Effie almost saw me do the killing, and I was like, what can I do? On the spot, and I just it was Durf, and I had no idea where Durf even was, but it's like I think I successfully made Effie doubt his eyes.
It was really funny when I was like, oh, I believe Andrew because he's just so indignant right now that it sounds so real, and I was like, wow, he really was the killer. So he was just faking how indignant he was, but then there's the double twist of like, no, he really was just trying to finish the task. He didn't give a fuck about being a killer, and that's why I didn't suspect him. It's because he just, it's like, what? And it's like, chat was like, that's an interesting killer strategy, is avoid sus by just never doing a single imposter thing in the entire match.
I still won, I guess it still worked, I just wanted to do the task.
The other player just won for you, didn't they?
Well, yeah, which is why I was saying, whenever it's just me as the imposter, that's why I always lose. It's because I don't want to do it, so I will lose. And anytime that I'm
just
a part of somebody...
You just refuse to play the game?
No, but if I'm a part of a team with some, like if there's another imposter with me, we will almost always win because I will do my best to be not suspicious. So I will survive till the end. And then if it's left over to where it's
so
like, well, it's
because
just
you have a complete... absence of sus, they'll just think somebody else is the suspect and vote them out of off because they have at least because they at least have the slightest dreg to latch on to.
Yeah, and I will definitely manipulate. I will lie and say like, no, it's not the person that is the killer. Like I know that is the killer. Like no, it's definitely the other person. But like I'm not gonna go out of my way to kill people. Like it's such a pain because I like every time I've tried doing that, every time the moment I kill someone, oh, someone walked up behind me. fuck it then. I'm done. I'm not going to sit here and I'm not going to fucking kill people and then get caught immediately doing it. And I can't talk my way out of it because, like, well, what were you doing last? I was doing a task in specimen. This task specifically seems kind of sus. Okay. Well, fine. Forget it. Just vote me off then. Let's end the round. Can I go play tasks now?
Like, every other round, you're like, hey, I finished my task. I don't give a fuck. Kill me.
Yeah, that's the thing, too. Someone's like, oh, we're going to vote you off. Fine. I'm done with my task. I don't give a fuck what you do now. I'm just going to sit here anyways. Like, I'm not going to follow you. I'm not going to watch you. I've done the thing I've wanted to do, which is I've done my task.
Every time there's, like, and an emergency meeting or something, you're like, why? Fuck, why?
I was doing my task.
Yeah, well, we need to vote off the bad guy. It's like, no, I need my tasks.
Like, I said it the one time, like, the lights were out and Durf got mad because someone, like, reported a body while he was trying to fix the lights. I was like, oh my god, he's right. I would be upset about that. And then the next time I found a body and the lights were out, I waited until someone fixed the lights and then reported the body. Because I was like, yeah. I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to upset somebody who's in the middle of doing a task. I get it. I completely get it.
Then you die in the dark.
I've had it so many times where, ooh, like, I'll be doing a task, like, specifically doing the download or upload task. I'm like, all right,
watching a meter, yeah, fill up, and then right when it's almost done, it gets interrupted.
Yes,
now I have to walk back there and do it again.
Yeah, that 3 seconds body reported. And I'm like, dude, I don't know who the killer is, but I'm gonna fucking get you right now because I just want to do my task and there's no reason we have to do this,
but you have to kill
right now.
I've had some really embarrassing moments in that game that the audience knows. Like, in the first few episodes, there was multiple instances of me just walking past bodies without noticing them. I just didn't register. I think there was outside where they just could have been clutter. Like, oh, it's a rock. Like, nope, that's Effie's body.
With a bone sticking out of it.
Yeah.
Damn.
But then, really, really embarrassingly, there was a part where I killed somebody and Effie immediately walked into the room. And I was like, oh my god, fuck, fuck, fuck. And I ran away. And then I'm like, oh my god, I can't believe he didn't see him. What the fuck's happening? Effie, what's wrong with you?
It's the vision.
But the whole time, Effie was the other killer, so I'm just fucking stupid.
And then
there's also a great moment where I'm like, I'm kind of in trouble here. And then, like, Bird, like, gives me an alibi, and he's like, Keith was up with me in the top right. And I'm like, why did he say it? What a weird mistake to make, but whatever. Like, I'll totally take this. Is this, like, false? This fucking false positive where Bird forgot who was with him and said it was me. Then, to my defense, the vote screen is all white names. But then we get out of the vote screen and we're running around. I'm like, oh right, Bird's the other imposter. He was lying.
No,
for
no,
me.
The vote screen is not a white names.
Yeah, no.
Isn't it white names or
no? No, no. The vote screen also tells you who the bad guys
are. Yeah, yeah.
I think I forgot.
Maybe it's a new patch.
Or maybe no, I don't know.
The last time, because the last time it was, I know that for a fact.
Whatever it was, I genuinely had this dumb thought moment of thinking that Bird made a mistake, as opposed to realizing, like, oh, he just gave me he gave me an alibi, so I'm clear.
Oh, you poor summer child.
Because he knows nobody was with him, so he can claim that I was with him, and then
That's the other thing too. Is like,
that's a good strategy, but a risky one. Is like, have the other imposter be your alibi. But only if unless they suspect you, then they're like, they're both murderers.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think Andrew plays the game really well. And I definitely couldn't ever suss you out.
First. I don't know.
Effie is really easy to tell when he's the murderer. His voice changes a little bit.
So where's Bonnie?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah,
he had a noticeable trend where the moment the body be reported, he'd be like, oh, so where's the body? Like, he wants to get out first that he doesn't know where the body is. And it's like, and he's so fast to it each time. It's because he made the body. And he wants to immediately have that happen. I think I might have seen my brother do the same thing.
I think he did that once.
My brother did have one of the rare solo imposter wins where he was the only imposter and he got everyone to kill each other.
Yeah. Also,
he was downstairs bragging about it afterwards to our housemates.
That was amazing. That was brilliant. That was all like mind games. That was fantastic.
Yeah.
I was right. I said it. I said it as I left.
You said it too hard though, because I lost the game because of you.
How did I say it too hard? I said it.
You said you lost it. And I'm like, oh well, I guess I'm gonna kill myself.
I was literally like, look, that's I can tell you, like, It has to be this person. It has to be him. There's no other person it could be. He literally left the room that the body was in. There's no reason.
I actually just got in contact with Snow to make him his avatar now because I need it for the thumbnails. Everyone will have a Snowvatar. You, what is it? Me, Colonel.
Snow? Is it Snow?
Marty.
Animations.
Yeah, they're... Now it says Robbie, because you can change your username on Twitter, but their handle is Snowy Snowwheelist. and they're originally...
No, I think their handle Snow Animations is their handle on Twitter.
No. It's Snowyillist. Yeah. Oh, Snowy Illustration, but
oh, yeah,
it's cut off.
Snowy,
but right. Yeah, their username that you can change used to be Snow Animation.
Yeah,
and some of their addresses are that and so on.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, Snow the Giant and stuff. Their art style is very varied, but like, I love it.
It can get really confusing how you can just change your Twitter name on the fly, and like some people have really confusing Twitter names because they just don't want people to find them in searches anymore or something. I don't know. I don't know the point.
Or did the same people all having the same username like Black Lives Matter or something like that?
Black Lives Matter, a lot of people add something afterwards.
No, I follow a couple of people that are just called Black Lives Matter. Then when I see them without the handle, I'm just like, which one is the one?
Who are you? How do I tell?
You could tell only if the handle shows up. Twitter is weird. Now we have the yeets instead of the tweets. Fleets, that's the one. Same potato.
I hate them. Yeah.
I keep seeing the meme people. Yeah, the free market will breed innovation. It's just every social media has a stories now, and it's like, all right, well, we tried, and now we've all got the stories. It's just another feature to me where I'm like, cool. This isn't what anybody asked for, but you did it, guys. Congratulations. Yeah. Clap, 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 clap. Like,
I was just randomly like, I guess I'll put this trash on here.
Yeah.
I had a pack of candy, and there was like one random one that was just spongy and empty feeling. I'm like, oh, this one just doesn't have anything in it. So I just like tried to awkwardly open it on camera. I'm like, wow, I did a fleet. Wow, there's nothing inside. Anyway, this will be gone tomorrow.
Do you think it's with the intention of having more advertising on Twitter than it already has?
It's just that a thing did really well, so they're like, I want that feature. I'll take that feature. Like, let's have so everyone's like, every platform has to have a short form video thing that goes away in a day, and everybody has to have a what's it called? Like a stories and stuff like that. Which I don't even fully understand because I haven't used the platform the stories were in. You just keep layering the same mechanics forever.
Yeah, I mean it's just like video games, just like everything where there's no consequence for copycatting is just like everyone's just gonna do the exact same thing that makes somebody successful until people go like, hey, wait, I don't like that anymore. It's like, oh shit, now I gotta do something else.
like the Guitar Hero games.
Yeah, I mean it's just it's normal.
All of a sudden, no more Guitar Heroes.
The difference is usually there's like enough there's enough incentive to be different because that is what will make you successful. I don't know. I think the thing that really upsets me is that no one has ever copied MySpace's like free customization. Like freedom
of
customization.
No. Free customization. Free is a bad word. What is this?
Well, not free, but the idea that you can customize completely your profile.
It needs to be paid,
like that, even if it's paid. I don't care about
that. I know what you mean.
It's you cannot customize your profile in any sense except for an avatar and a header is like the most asinine thing I've ever seen. Where it's like,
I think it's because it everyone has trash taste, and so it made the website look bad. Because you would constantly see these insufferable, horrible websites that you didn't want to look at, with their automatically playing Nickelback songs and so on.
That's why people remember MySpace fondly and don't like Facebook. It's because MySpace had personality.
You would open up someone's MySpace page and it was like an infinitely tiling copy of like Leroy Jenkins, and then the background goes, "How the hell we wind up like this?" It's like, oh my god, stop it. Fucking
beautiful. Dude, that is exactly what the internet should be. That is memorable. It's funny. It's like, it is
like a YMTDPDTP, whatever it was called.
It is so beautiful. But then you go to like Twitter and you go to a profile and you're like, wow, that's
and then
never
everyone
really cool.
Had like glittering GIFs of like text and garbage. Or it was so trash.
You could change the like mouse cursor because there was an HTML tag for that. You could change like, oh my god, you could make certain things invisible. So you could literally just have a profile that has your picture and nothing else.
Yeah.
It was so
You still
good.
Have that, but like I think the market changed because you still can do that in WordPress.com or Blogger or whatever.
But no one uses any of those things.
Social media sites. Social media
The most popular websites where you could customize your profile extensively, like on a visual, at least having a background and whatnot, were MySpace and YouTube. And MySpace,
used to do that,
and they both just like formatted it out because MySpace is now only a music band website, and YouTube also, like they just got rid of the custom profiles, so you just have a banner and a.
But
avatar.
What makes what made specifically MySpace a social media website that a Blogger or a WordPress.com isn't?
People were on it. It also had like friends lists and connections to people.
Makes it a social media website is because it was a site specifically for connecting with other people, whereas a WordPress is a blog website just for people to come read your blog.
You're just updating your note thing constantly, and then you have to like contact your friends manually outside of the website and tell them like, here's the URL to my blog, and like, cool, not looking.
MySpace was like that. I thought
MySpace had a blog built into it, but it also had comments. It had a profile, like
people
a picture
could comment on
system.
Your page, and you had friends lists, and there was like some unified notifications.
You could join groups, you can customize your profile, and even like WordPress is like, that's it's solo, it's your own island.
You can have multiple authors.
But they cannot customize their own.
There's a lot of freedom.
But like what Facebook changed about everything was that they took MySpace, and then it was then like, oh, what if everyone's posts roll on a continuous feed and you're all in one place? And then so you had the one scrolling wall, and that pretty much was all that mattered.
Yeah.
I think that's the big paradigm of social media these days, is the big scrolling wall.
Yeah, but then that had to be a neutral and uncharacterized location because there wasn't anybody's place.
And so everything takes place inside of an infinite feed. Someone was just like, what if we made RSS feeds visual? And that was it. And so now you just have this relentlessly ending.
Yeah,
or never
so everyone fled to Tumblr, which is now the most popular website where you can make a profile like that.
Yeah, Tumblr's like the last place that you can.
Is this still going?
Yeah, Tumblr's still there.
Tumblr's like the most social blog page.
Yeah, Tumblr's like the last remnant of, hey, that thing that makes the internet really interesting is still here.
Yeah, because it's like a confusing halfway point between like MySpace and Twitter.
Yeah, the only
downside is you like share each other's things and so on, and there's a feed.
Yeah, the downside is that Tumblr isn't profitable enough to be really like enjoyable to use. Like a lot of the watching videos on there is ass, much like Twitter, where you watch something, or Reddit, where you click on a video and it like kind of loads and then it fails, and you reload it and then it kind of gets halfway through and then it fails and you reload it and you're like,
it's weird,
god, this is just so hard. When MySpace had like 15 songs playing on repeat, How did this get so hard?
I don't understand why they have so much trouble. I think it's the servers. They just get overloaded with video.
No, it's people are cheap. Because the thing is that
they don't have good enough servers.
I mean, social media isn't a profitable venture. It's never a good... no one should make a social media site because it's a stupid waste of money.
Yes.
You can kind of
if somebody pays you to do it. That's how you should make it.
So the only way you can make money with social media is if you have Facebook level amount of users, because then you do what Facebook does, either sell the information that those users generate in the groups that they like, the pictures they upload, the things that they say, and the ads that you can cater to them, or you turn to Twitter, and Twitter isn't profitable, but their business model is that eventually people will run into ads in the feed, and those ads can be clicked on and thus generate revenue for a business. And that's like, that's what Instagram does. That's what Reddit does. That's what Twitter does. That's what Tumblr does. And it's both of those are.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say both of those are, you know, aren't enough on its own to make the site profitable enough to be worth the money you invest in keeping it running. And so that's why you have like, you have other lucrative ventures. Like that's why Facebook does more than just Facebook. That's why they have like Oculus, and that's why they have Instagram. That's why they have WeChat and shit, is because you can make money in other places a lot easier. And like, that's why Facebook focuses heavily on their Messenger app. It's because you can send money through Messenger, and every time you send money through Messenger, they get a cut of the money. Or if you send money through WeChat, which is popular in like outside of the United States, and people send money through it, they get some of that money. Like, there's you need like a social media is a great platform to jump off of, but you shouldn't go out of your way to make a social media website and make that your business, because it will always be a bad idea financially. And
unless you have a lot of money and luck out.
Which is how Twitter survived, is because Twitter kept getting funding somehow, and I don't know who...
I don't understand either.
Yeah. I don't know who was bankrolling Twitter, but man, they are just complete bad at their money. But they just continue...
I'm sure they're still making money at being bad at their money, because that's how it works.
No, yeah, tech companies don't make sense.
Yeah.
At some point, the rules were just rewritten so that if you're a tech company, you don't have to actually succeed at making money, and you can just keep not making money forever. And I can't explain even why some of them somehow go under, but other ones magically live forever while never making money. And it's just like, eh, whatever.
My job is like, I work at a startup, and we've been around for about 4 or 5 years now, and we are still in funding phase. Like we're still not making money. And I'm like, I don't understand how this works.
This business model?
Like,
how do so many companies just not make money on principle, and they just keep going, but so many other companies and like mom and pop shops are just like, you know, go fuck yourself.
Because
you didn't make money for a month, you're homeless.
So the reason this happens is because there is a specific rule about what constitutes a startup and what you're allowed to do as a startup. And so as a startup, because business in America is bad. And because we've consolidated all business into like 6 or 7 companies, trying to make new business in America is a fool's errand. And so to facilitate more business being made, because no one's doing it anymore, you make startups more affordable by giving them leniency in the way that they are allowed to generate capital. And so because they're allowed to generate capital by going out and getting funding from angel investors or Series C, like different types of ways they can get funding, it means that a company that is new and starting up can survive even if they're not profitable enough to like take on Amazon. But the problem in that is that, of course, like all capitalism, there's a loophole that you can exploit to just keep staying in a position where you can keep generating, you can keep getting funding. So you can keep requesting funding while not turning a profit, but still staying open for years. And because if you cut that loophole off, it could harm a lot of small businesses from actually coming into existence. But there is no other way you can like, there's no way you could stop people from exploiting it, but there is no way that you can make the system work fairly without tearing down what already exists. Because yeah, like how do you open a mom and a pop shop when Walgreens, Walmart, Target, Home Depot, like every major retailer exists that can do whatever the fuck you want to do 2 times better. And like, so there's no way you can
establish laws that prevent actual What's the word when there's only one company taking care
monopoly.
Of a thing? Actual monopolies, yeah. Because it's the biggest delusion to think that just because the companies have different names and are under different ownerships, that they're not a monopoly.
Okay,
it happens with the communications companies. It happens with
I just thought of an example. And so we did that and it failed.
It so, didn't. The yeah, last it, time the U.S. No, did this was
it
back,
failed
back
dramatically. Do you remember Pac Bell?
I wasn't gonna reference Pac Bell. I was gonna reference the iron ones back in the '50s.
Okay, because Pac Bell was like the most recent atrocity to like, hey, we did it, guys. We broke up a monopoly, and then it became a new monopoly, and then we couldn't break it up because it became too important to stability. Like AT&T only exists because Pac Bell got broken up, and AT&T mm-hmm. was. So Pac Bell was a huge all-encompassing telecoms company. It had everything from computers to cell phones. And it got so big to a point where the government was like, okay, you have to like break this apart. You have to have a telecommunications branch, a computer branch, whatever branch. You cannot have everything under one umbrella. And so they went, okay, they broke it apart. AT&T then went and said, but what if we just start consuming all the telecos? And so they started consuming all of the teleco companies. And so they consumed Singular, they consumed everything else. And then they went, but what if we consumed Pac Bell? And so they ate Pac Bell and took over its entire operations. And now AT&T is so big that it can't be broken up, because if you break it up into small pieces, you can't. You will cripple so many subsidiaries underneath.
You just need to change the paradigm. The thing is, there's no interest
what happens
from...
So what happens to Rooster Teeth? What happens to Viacom? What happens to like all of these companies that rely heavily on funding from AT&T to exist? Because if you cut Viacom out of AT&T, it won't survive on its own. It will die. And thus, when it dies, all these things that it's connected to will also die.
The problem is
you've created this tumor. Like most of American businesses are tumors on the economy. And if you cut them, that means you take a huge chunk of the economy with it.
The economy suffers a lot. That's why there's no political interest in breaking up companies. Even companies that would work a little bit better, like Google and Facebook, they could be and should be broken up. Even those companies or Apple even, they're a tremendous hit to the economy. Because when we say economy, what we're really talking about is the speculation that surrounds the market, the stock market, and that's the real economy. And that's how everybody who has money makes money, is through that speculation. It's completely detached from what actually happens and of the profits that exist. And it's not unique to the startups. It's detached from other companies as well. I mean, we just need to look at the stocks right now during the beginning of winter 2020. And this podcast is only going to get more relevant as time goes by, because people are going to look back and they're going to see this happening. But the stocks just keep growing. It doesn't matter. Well, so what? If we're in the biggest recession of our lives, it doesn't matter. It's fine.
Well, I mean, a recession only affects those who are like affects the working class, really.
That's every recession is like that.
Well, yeah, but I'm saying you can just like when it comes to stock trading, you can just move your money into different markets and keep it steady and afloat. You don't have like it's not unless it becomes an economic like.
But the thing is, what happened with the stock market is that it used to be that, yes, you could move your money from this company or to that company as they failed. And certainly in the overall picture, they just kept growing, even though some companies failed. But we're not at that level. We're just beyond. Like, it doesn't matter the actual reality, the actual predictions. It doesn't matter if the predictions are there. Or if they're not, if they're real or if they're not, we're just going to, because people are spending money on the companies, then they are worth money and people will continue spending money. That's just what's called speculation. The term itself, I'm not an economist, so I don't know the details, but the term itself, as far as I understand, it comes from the speculation in originally comes from the speculation in real estate. Where what you're investing isn't the value of the land, but rather the value of the money you're going to be able to make out of that land. And that's why real estate speculation is so prevalent today, but also why it's so much of a problem is because it's very easy for you to know that that land is very valuable in the long term. So you're going to pay a lot of money because you're going to get it back in the long term. But that happens with companies as well. That happens if you spend money on Tesla. And just look at Tesla and how much they're growing. It's just that they're growing in stocks, mind you. They're not necessarily growing as a company. Tesla is a good example for that, I feel.
Yeah, I don't... Unfortunately, I don't know enough about...
Yeah, I don't know enough about either.
I don't know enough about economics to tell you how to fix the problem. I can just tell you that it's too late to fix. Like, much like climate change, it's too late now. You've already fucked it. The problem is, like, figuring out what's going to replace it. There's not, like, a... There is no, like, oh, we can do it, guys. We'll go back to before times. No, it's gone. You just need to figure out what will replace it when it dies. And, like, that's the problem.
I don't think climate change is gone. Like, it might be impossible to stop, but it isn't impossible. The thing is, there's two different types of impossibility. There's the impossibility of, I don't know, I'm never going to be a million subscriber YouTuber. That's impossible. But there's also the impossibility of, or the possibility of maybe I could be. Like, if everybody subscribed to me, I could be a million subscriber YouTube. It's not an impossibility. And it's the same with climate change. I'm equating climate change to my YouTube channel.
I mean, unless we...
Of course.
Personally, unless... yeah. I'm of the decision. There's only two avenues right now, or three avenues for climate change. Either we all start living underground...
Nah, that wouldn't change anything.
A la Gurren Lagann style, where we just wait for like 2,000 years and then the Earth fixes itself while we're gone. Or we go and find a new planet to live on and hope it has everything the same as Earth does.
It's not about us.
We just sit here and die slowly and enjoy the ride while we've got it, which is what we're going to do. We're going to sit here and wait until we die from it.
Your mistake, though.
That's what humans always do. We just sit and wait till we die from things.
Your mistake is saying we as humans. Climate change isn't we humans. It's the system that we humans made. But
foxes are like going out of the way and ruining the planet.
It's not all of us that are making climate change.
Yes,
it's the 1%.
Are you out there right now killing the 1%? Because unless you're out there killing the 1%, you're part of the problem. Like, apathy is a problem, and apathy is the reason this has gotten to the way it is. If you don't want to...
It's impossible, then.
Are you going to go out tomorrow and kill the 1%?
I don't think you need to kill them. No, I mean, although bring out the guillotines.
You have to kill them. You have
bring
to
out the guillotines. But
you can't talk cancer away.
This whole thing is basically like... It's basically them on the path to climate change, grinding that Tony Hawk rail, playing the little balancing game where on both sides of the balancing game is guillotines.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, absolutely. But I think it is possible. What I mean is, like, it's precisely that. It is possible to fix it, but are the conditions necessary for that possibility going to happen?
I can tell you in just a second. How
does it take to make a guillotine? How to DIY a guillotine?
All right, so let's see. We've been here for 6 million years. I'm gonna say no. We're not gonna fix it. We're kind of fucking dumb. We've had six million years and we can't get. We don't. This is where we've gotten. This is the
capitalism
best we've achieved.
Capitalism hasn't been here for 6 million years.
And that already tells you enough.
I mean, with that in mind, it's actually very important to have that in mind when you're analyzing the numbers.
I would argue it's been like a couple thousand years at most, we have basically been on the track to destroying this planet in speedrun mode. Like, I don't think we even have been
thousands
a threat.
Of years.
Yeah, probably right.
I mean, maybe if you talk about like our danger to species.
Well,
like the
I
way
meant
that
more
we
of
hunt,
a,
we hunt things through I'm, extinction, but like the
I
industrial
meant more of like
revolution
the way that
was
we,
much more recent.
Well, yeah, but I meant more of farming. Yeah. Farming is also a contributor.
It isn't. Farming is good. No, there's definitely sustainable ways of farming, and like,
I meant like holding
maybe
animals.
Maybe Europeans don't do it throughout
the way that we hunt so much of the world to extinction, but then there's 50 billion cows.
Yeah,
because that's the other thing when we think just humans are we're just bad because we farm or because we things and we because we do things, we're absolutely forgetting all the indigenous people all throughout the world that have been doing it for millennia in completely sustainable ways.
don't
including
know.
In Europe, to be fair, including in Europe, even Europe has some sustainable agriculture throughout history.
It seems impressive to me that we seem to have an almost limitless amount of studies pointing to exactly the things that are causing problems, and no one's doing anything to stop that. They're just like, yeah, that's not real. Oh, okay.
I think like, I don't think that's true. Good. I think we have more and more movement around climate change in terms of protests, in terms of like the fact that we are talking about it in this podcast right now. And maybe 20 years ago, we wouldn't, because, I mean, what's that?
Because I was a little baby. Well, I was 10, actually.
Well, 20 years ago, there was a lot of limitations in what humans could be doing.
No, we have known climate change is an issue for more than 100 years.
No, not climate change. I meant like you're not going to find podcasts 20 years ago. Because humans couldn't do that. Technology has progressed us to a way that we're allowed to be completely awful to one another in real time, in a way that no other humans on Earth have been allowed to do so. Like, it's a great time to be alive.
Climate change is simultaneously a failing of both capitalism and democracy.
Yeah.
Because on one hand, on the capitalist level, like, it's incentivized to just make the problem worse for as long as possible, as long as you can get away with it. Yeah, because it's profitable. And that's the only rule.
That's the only thing that matters to both government and
There is no charity clause or we're all in this together clause of capitalism. Yeah. It's just profit. That's the only rule that matters. The only extent to which you do anything nice ever is because of the background noise of guillotines. I was like, better not piss them off enough. And with the advent of internet and social media and YouTube and so on, like there's plenty of ways to distract people and keep them from doing that. And that's totally possible.
Although, to be fair,
that's why everyone's mad when we talk about these things. They're like, you're ruining my distraction where I'm spending my whole life trying to pretend this isn't happening.
I think there are fewer ways to keep people distracted these days than there were even.
No, absolutely not.
The advent of the internet is such a boom for, like, it's so much harder to control the information for like, it used to be that you had a few channels on TV and that's what you watched. And if you went to the movies, that was the movies. And if you read some books, it's because you were already like outside of the norm. I think the reason why populism, especially far right populism, has grown so much is precisely because it's so difficult to control the narrative.
Yeah, it's difficult to contain information, but it's also such a barrage that's also easy to distract people with it.
Yeah,
although not nearly as much as it's easy to distract people with working.
I mean,
it's super noticeable that like we keep having atrocities happening all the time every year. But this year specifically, there was massive protests. It's like, oh, the one where everyone just lost their jobs, like the year where everyone just lost their jobs to the virus is the year where everyone's suddenly available to protest. It's like, oh, yeah, because the distraction of working all the time was like the gradient shifted of how many people were so busy working all the time that they can't ever get a way to actually care about things.
Yeah, it's not possible to have right-wing, like far-right-wing propaganda unless there's enough distractions to make it possible. Like a normal non-busy person
also
could easily
creepy,
look and go,
shitty
wait a
breeding
second.
Pits like 4chan.
Yeah, like how do you look at policies and go like, yeah, these look exactly the things that are going to punish me. I love it. Keep doing it. Like, what? No, no one looks and goes like, yeah, you know what? Me, as a minimum wage worker, want to keep minimum wage low forever. Good idea. I'm going to vote for that. No, you have to be literally blind or being distracted heavily by non-political media in order to like let this kind of thing happen in the background.
I think there's a lot of self-hate in a lot of communities that also fuels self-destructive
Some
policies.
Of it's deserving. I would wish some groups would self-hate a little bit more. It'd be a little bit more, learn some humility, guys.
What I mean is like when you say like you see that parodied. I was playing a game the other day and I saw that parodied and it reminded me of that dynamic where somebody says, you know, people who can't make a living out of their work shouldn't be given money by the state to have food. And those same people who say that could very well be not be able to make a living out of their work, and they would still say that. They will still hate on the welfare queens, which is just a racist stereotype in the first place.
But I'm special and different somehow in my predicament.
No, it's just that, you know, it's self-hating. It's just that they ignore part of their reality to just sort of allow themselves to say the hateful things that they feel.
It's also just a unrealistic belief that anything that they do to affect the goal that they seek, which is to be wealthy, like at least in the US, the whole point is to like be wealthy. That's the game.
That's the American dream.
Yeah. And if you're not succeeding, then you're failing. And so if you do anything to affect those that are succeeding, it is not viewed favorably by the people who are failing because they think they're going to get there someday. And spoiler alert, unless you're making $150,000 right now, you're failing. You're an absolute fucking unit of a failure. In fact, if you died right now, it would only benefit the country. So, like, yeah. Or we can change.
I think your perspective on economics is a little bit skewed.
We could turn it around, and the reason I say that is because the people in the back of the bus here are not great. They're useless. They're just sucking money away from the.
You're forgetting
capitalist
that the reason why the capitalist queens actually suck the money away is that there are so many people working. And that's the part of the reason.
No, they would make
reason.
More money if there were less people. They would replace them with robots, and then they wouldn't have to pay anybody.
It's not the only reason, but it's one of the reasons.
Why do jobs just leave this country? That's weird. It's weird, right?
Why does the United States still have one of the lowest unemployment? Not now, because...
We have the highest. We're doing pretty good on that
now. But that's also an indictment of the system, but just in a different manner. But... Back at the end of last year, why did the United States have one of the lowest unemployment rates of the entire Northern Hemisphere?
Because that didn't account for people.
Work is fundamental.
Because it didn't account for people who had like multiple jobs.
All countries are the same. All countries don't account for people who are not registered. It's just a bunch of things.
How do you find? Here's my thing is like, how do you gauge the difference between like unemployment and ineligible to work, like people on disability? How do you find those people? Is it people who like submit unemployment benefits, people who look for like some kind of welfare? Is that how you find who's unemployed? Because I see a lot of homeless people that I definitely don't think are part of the census or the unemployment check, because no one seems to talk to them. So I'm under the impression that like there's a lot of people just sitting in the background here that aren't a part of this statistic. And it looks really good on paper, but like, is it real?
Yeah, well, the unemployed is determined by people who are searching for a job and can't find one. Mm-hmm.
That's the same in many countries.
Yeah, which I mean... I don't think that's an exact number. I think there's probably a lot more people that aren't looking for jobs that are also on, like, there are people who are on social benefits that aren't looking for employment.
There's two layers of, like, one, I think I'm wondering how it's being polled. And at the same time, I'm also like, that's not necessarily the best measurement of actual employment rate.
But what I'm saying is that those problems apply to all countries. Or most countries, as far as I know.
Well, sure, but there's a noticeable problem with companies trying to find cheaper and cheaper labor.
Yeah,
and the reason is because working class people are a blight to business. They do nothing but drain what is profit. And if you can create a perfect utopia where all you do is create product to service other rich people, then you've created the perfect capitalism. Because then you don't have to pay anybody, and you get to keep all of the profits at the end of it. And
you're forgetting that you can't. As long as you don't have the money being sucked out of the poor, there's no money to be gained by the rich. Yes, they will trade between each other.
Yeah,
but that's how it worked. That's literally what the stock market is.
A stock market is just trading money amongst rich people. There's no product you're getting in a stock market.
Because the stock market keeps growing. If that were the case, inflation would be, like monetary inflation, would be directly tied to the stock market, which it is, well, obviously.
I mean, you have to remember, too, that there's, again, previously, this is not an obtainable thing. There's no way you could automate jobs. Like, what?
Even now, there's no way. Like, there's service.
There's literally a factory that builds PS3s. There's people necessary. Like, that's
who
crazy.
Makes the games? Who answers the telephone call? Who sells them?
Soon it can be robots. Robots.
But what happens is that manufacturing becomes robot.
I just like the idea that the factory is still just hanging out building PS3s.
Yeah. It's a real thing.
What I mean is that it's very true and very, very big problem that automation is going to take away jobs to the exclusive betterment of the rich. No, it's because it would be great if it weren't just for the fucking rich that I don't want to work.
I get fucking maybe 90 years on this planet. They will give you nothing,
Andrew.
And I don't want to work it.
They will give you nothing. They will make their factories.
I don't have to.
And they will give you nothing.
Look, all I need is
you're ready for that Star Trek reality where so many jobs have become automated that mostly people just don't even engage with an economy anymore.
Let me just finish my thought.
Self-fulfillment.
I love that.
I think that attitude is because you're forgetting that what happens when automation exists, and this has happened since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, is that more and more jobs start becoming service based, and it's called the tertiary industry. It's like there's like these old school ways of looking at the economy, and there's like primary, secondary, and tertiary. And primary is like agriculture and just basic stuff, mining and stuff. And then secondary is manufacturing and transport and all sort of stuff. And then tertiary is services, entertainment, that sort of stuff. And that's what happens. And it happens in the U.S.
What do you mean services?
Doctors and people who you pay to deal with, like...
Oh, we can automate that. We don't need that anymore. We have, like, automatic waiters. We have automatic cooks. We have automatic...
But that has never happened.
Haven't you seen Star Wars Episode 3?
It's also... China has a lot of... a lot of the restaurants are being serviced by automated, like, waiters.
Yeah, that's secondary. That's secondary.
That's secondary? That's a service job.
No, it's a service. Yeah, it is. That's true. But it's still like it's secondary industry.
If a human can do it, we can make a robot for it. Humans aren't special. In fact, they're the least optimal thing on the planet. Robots are like way better at doing repetitive tasks.
Then who makes the robots?
People.
Yes.
Well, for now. Sorry. People make robots for now until robots will make them later, because robots are also way better at making robots than we are. So they will be the ones that will make.
Kicking the can down the road, though, for the fundamental question. Who owns the means of production? Yes.
The robots.
That is the question. But who owns the robots?
Will own the means.
Who owns
the robots? The robots own themselves.
Is the question.
That's the thing. The robots will make themselves owners. They will.
It's all right if they make a factory that costs no money. Which is a lie also, by the way. All of this stuff
is predicated, a factory could be self-sustaining.
No, it is absolutely predicated on the abuse and exploitation of people in third world countries.
Well, that's how you get cheap labor. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
You can make it even cheaper
by
automating.
Let's forget about that particular detail. Which we shouldn't forget in the long run, but still the point is, it's all right
spoilers
if they make a factory.
All the third world.
It's all right if they make a factory.
I don't know who came up with a weird classification system of first, second, and third, but they were definitely fudging the numbers there.
That has to do with the Cold War.
I just mean the Cold War thing. I just mean because we're on Earth.
No, that's what I'm saying. We're all third world. We're not.
It's all right if they make a factory.
Someone's acting like there's a better country on Earth. No, you're on
Mercury
Earth.
Mercury is not better. It's horrible there.
Well, yeah, Mercury is not
great. It's on fire, yo.
But yeah. there's a planet like light years away that's probably way better than Earth. Like, God, probably got like way cooler stuff. They probably have trees made of chocolate.
That's the ultimate tragedy.
At least light millennia away.
That's the tragedy, though. It's not for us. It's not good for us. Like, any planet can be good for life that has developed there. But for us, it's only Earth. Everything else sucks.
Clearly, you've never met humans. Anything could be good for us if we make it, and that's what we always do.
Are you kidding me?
We crush everything to be made.
We'll just go there and wreck that.
Yeah. Somebody sneezed over yonder, and now the world has stopped.
Have you not watched Avatar? We just show up, even if we can't breathe there, we will take the natives and turn them into us. Like, we'll do whatever it takes to make humans live on a planet.
The romanticization? Yeah. Romanticization of space exploration and space colonization is just really... I think it's just really a retelling of actual colonization on Earth. And we're just sort of... Let's forget that it's impossible to live outside of the Earth. It's not impossible. It's just very difficult.
I mean, realistically, if you want it like to be super philosophical, what's even the purpose then? What the hell are people here for?
Here where?
Living. Why would literally any fucking thing create a human? Of all things you could create, why would you create a human? What a terrible decision on any part. Either nature, God, whatever, no reason to create this abomination of a cockroach life form that does nothing but infest a planet, destroy it from the inside out, and then goes on its way to find new places to destroy. You've created the Zerg. And why would you have done this?
that's a meritorious question, but it is also informed by not having to fight for so many things that so many people fight for daily.
Also, why would we have to fight? We just show up to a new planet. There's no other intelligent life form. You just kind of
we just talked about the protests earlier this year in the United States. There's so many people fighting for the police not to shoot them. There's so many people fighting for them having PPEs where they don't, and they have to work in hospitals and stuff. And people who don't have food and are being bombed, or people whose land is being taken away, or who are just in concentration camps, or their uteruses are being removed without them knowing.
I mean, this would be a lot easier if you just got rid of all the humans and replaced them with robots.
We just need to selectively get rid of some of the humans. Do you know what I mean? It's the guillotines, abolish ICE, and then we go on.
This is like one of those things of like, well, if you just teach everybody, yeah, but there's always going to be bad people. But you could always just remove the bad problem, which is
the bad problem
is humans. Like, humans are the problem.
No, it's just the ones on top.
You can get rid of them.
The poor ones are good. Everybody is nice.
No, there are no good humans.
Just because somebody who just works all their life doesn't care about any stuff and just, you know, goes on having kids.
Wow, what a privileged life. You don't care about anything, the struggles going on.
Just because the normal person has the potential to become a horrible monster if given the enough power. Like, somebody comes to mind. Was it that...
Everybody?
Keith, you do you know who I'm talking about? He's orange. I don't... Anyway, the point is... just because a normal person...
Orange still on TV? I thought they canceled that show.
What I mean is, just because people have the potential to become horrible when given enough power doesn't mean that they're horrible. And it is true that they have the potential, but that doesn't mean that people are horrible.
I think that makes them horrible. Yeah, I don't believe in the idea that power corrupts people.
I think power doesn't corrupt people. What happens is, when you give people power, you just get to see what that guy or girl was gonna do if it had enough power and money.
I'm under the impression that if like.
They were either already corrupted or not.
And most people are already corrupted.
I'm not saying that power corrupts people.
I am sure they're perfectly good people. I'm sure they're people
What I'm saying is that
kind-hearted, lovable, perfect people. And you know what? Get rid of them too. Because all you're doing is you're doing a favor for the rest of the planet.
No, because like,
you're thinking of it in the sense that you would be annihilated because you're a human, and that is the arrogance. Humans are the problem. Go ask any other animal. Go ask a tiger.
Humans
if
are
they
not
want
the problem.
Humans dead.
It's
just go straight.
It's some of the humans.
If you ask a tiger which human to kill, it will kill any human. It doesn't.
It'll
care.
Kill you. It'll kill you.
Exactly.
You are asking the tiger,
and that's the problem.
Nom, nom.
You know what tigers wouldn't kill? A robot.
What I'm saying is, well, if he was dressed like a...
What is happening?
It would be
so,
too scared of the
I've
robot.
So
because
lost
it knows
at this point.
Because a robot would be able to assert its intelligent dominance over any life form, knowing its efficiency or knowing its ability to be more efficient than it is arrogant or corrupted. And it would show up, T-pose a tiger, and the tiger would be like, fuck, man, I'm out. That's it. The robot is way better than me. But a human can't do that. Human T-pose a tiger is going to get killed immediately because we're weak. We're garbage. We're imperfect creatures. We're not good enough tigers. Nope. Any case, realistically, the problem is that you're never going to... You can't fix a lot of problems unless you make the problems profitable to fix. And solutions are never profitable. Problems are profitable. It's always more... You always can make more money by breaking things than you can by solving
things. I think the solution is so that, like, none of us here, and possibly none of us listening to this podcast, has any power that is actually relevant. By ourselves, we can't do anything. Like, we can think we like.
I don't think anybody has that power, really. Yeah. It all takes collaboration. It's just a different type of...
But I think the first step towards collaboration is rooted in having these discussions and having understandings like this. And I think it is defeatist to think we're never going to be able to do anything. That's not the issue. Whether our hope is founded on anything value or on anything like real or on just us being hopeful or not hopeful, that doesn't really matter. What matters at the end of the day is that we understand the situation and that we talk to other people about the situations that we're in and that other people understand that as well. And maybe they don't think like we do or they have a different perspective, because you know that's also the thing. Like we're talking about this like for an hour or however long. We have barely grazed the surface. We're just sort of goofing around. There's so many other ways of looking at it and having a much deeper understanding of the issues that like us together, if we just like try to think about this sort of stuff and talk to each other about this, I think that's the start. It's not the start now. It has been like that since forever. It's just that, you know, young kids, They don't have a lot of time on this earth because they are young and so they need to start somewhere and that's why you see enthusiasm from kids like in regards to climate change in specific but also other aspects of life.
I think when you tell children like, hey, by the way, we kind of like YOLO'd your fucking planet, we're gonna be dead soon, the like results of that, and they're like, wait, what, you did what to our fucking planet?
Don't tell them like that, because that's not true. Us individually, we didn't do it. It's the, like you said before, that governments care about profit.
Apathy is way stronger than capitalism. Like apathy can destroy anything.
Apathy is grown like a garden. They do it on purpose. The apathy.
What do you mean they?
Apathy,
when you say they, it's like I'm not under a gun with no gun to my head telling me to be apathetic. I'm apathetic because why give a shit?
Not like, you individually, but like everybody collectively is pushed towards apathy on purpose.
I don't get how that's somebody else's
because that's
fault.
Profit-y.
That's completely on the person.
That's profitable. Because that's profitable. You were saying it before. As long as it's profitable, it works. And it is profitable to make people apathetic.
And my thing is, either you give a shit or you don't. Like, apathy isn't forced on you. No one can force apathy on a person. Like, there's not... when I watch TV, going like, don't go outside, don't look out your window,
That it isn't forced, though. If you're, like, it's... Well, how should I put this? If you live in a society that speaks English and learns about English things and all that, and you speak English, nobody forced you to learn English or speaking. Nobody forces you to speak English. Because if you want to speak German, you can speak German if you learn. You know what I mean?
I don't think that's true, but okay.
If you want to talk, like, I live in a society, I started living in a society that speaks Portuguese, and I chose to speak English, but nobody forces me to speak Portuguese, but still, I did it for long, and I do, right?
When did you start learning English?
Like, 20 years ago or something? Maybe?
Yeah, 15? I wasn't even aware there was other languages until, like, halfway through middle school?
Yeah, I knew more.
I had no awareness that there was like Spanish or other languages because I never
encountered
it.
That's just how the U.S. education system
middle
is.
School?
Yeah, I didn't. I don't. Keith,
there's
I don't pay
so much
to people.
Spanish in California.
I don't.
Holy shit.
But it wasn't in video games, so I didn't encounter it. When was I going to encounter Spanish?
What
I don't go talk
mean?
To fucking.
What I mean is nobody forces you to.
I refuse to believe
English.
You didn't have any anime in your life when you're in middle school.
That's when I learned about anime.
Oh.
I started watching anime in middle school, but it was in English. And then I realized, like, oh, I want to watch more of it. And I can only find it in Japanese. Like, what the fuck's Japanese? And you listen to it, you're like, oh, this is in English. I don't know what the fuck they're talking. And then I look it up and it's like, oh, yeah, you want to learn other languages? I was like, no, I want to learn the one that has anime in it.
Let me just finish my point about forcing.
Sorry, go for it.
Because I think it's a good analogy. Nobody forces anybody to speak a language. It's for sure, it's tough to learn another language, but you live in a country that speaks a language, you speak that language, that's it. But just
because, I feel like that's forcing. That's societal pressure.
In the individual sense, it isn't. You can say nobody forces me to speak English, and you can go and learn, and you can. But the thing is, you can't blame individual choice on the American people speaking majoritively English. It's not individual's choice. It's like that thing. The system works in a way that people talk to each other. They have the same language, and economics works on that as well. There's economic systems, and capitalism is one of those systems where it's very good to make sure that the people don't think about this sort of stuff, that people are apathetic towards societal change. And it applies to other things as well, not just economic issues, like racial issues as well, and justice issues, where apathy is cultivated by everybody that wants to gain money, because that's how you gain money. Because if you have a clientele that is going to complain to you that you make your hats in Africa or not Africa, China or East Asia with people that throw themselves off windows because they're so freaking overworked, or people who don't have to eat and need to eat bats, and then you blame the plague on them because they freaking don't have literally anything else to work with or to eat.
I'll be honest, I can't really do much about that. That's a different country.
Well, that's why I started off.
What can I do about a different country mistreating its
people? Yeah, I'm agreeing with you. That's why I started. Like, we individually don't have power. Individually, we don't.
I mean, I can change my own country. If I live in a country where people work 24 hours a day and jump out windows, I could definitely go and say, hey, this isn't fucking cool. I don't think you could start changing the laws.
I think you'd be arrested and nobody would hear from you again.
I mean, that sounds like an individual problem. Maybe you should not live in a country like that. Maybe you should overthrow that country. Maybe you should, I don't know.
It's not individual. It's understanding the systems and understanding why people are the way they are. Because if you ask yourself, are people apathetic towards any issue, not just climate change, but are people apathetic? I would say yes, as a majority. But then you need to ask, why is that? Why are they apathetic? And it's what Keith said, because they're overworked. The part of it is because propaganda, obviously. Part of it is because they just don't see. Like, I've heard arguments of people being like, if climate change was real, then why are they not doing anything about it? Like, the same people who tell me climate change is real, they're the same people that continue paying the oil companies to continue drilling. Because that's my other point that I sort of lost along the way. You said before that governments care if it's profitable. And I said, no, they don't. Because they actually don't. It's super, it's not very difficult to find examples of it. And I just don't know any right now, but it's every once in a while I'll see somebody talk about how ridiculous it is that certain industries are completely subsidized by the government, and the oil industry is definitely one of those, especially in the United States, maybe not so much in other countries, and here in Portugal it is also very subsidized by the government.
We destabilize an entire region of the planet so that we can have more oil and make more money.
An entire army just for the oil industry.
Yeah, and I would say that's probably because it's profitable. And I'd probably say it's profitable for what our governments care about.
It's profitable for not for the government. It's profitable for the individuals responsible for the government.
Our government literally said, go and die for the economy. I think they do whatever is profitable.
But not for the government. I think it's like running a company.
No, those were government people.
No, what I mean is the government isn't the people in the government. The government is just the entity. It's just sort of like the represent. What I mean to say is that if you say the government cares about what's profitable, you can't be talking about the embezzlement and about the personal investments of the people in the government. You need to, if you say the government cares about what's profitable, you need to think about it as the government as an entity as a whole detached from the people, right? I think that, you know what I mean? Because it doesn't work otherwise.
People who make decisions for the government care solely about the profitability of other companies because they have investments in those companies. And the government isn't a entity. It is not its own conscious thinking individual. It's a culmination of hundreds of very selfish capitalists. So I don't, again, the government only cares about what's profitable because it's run by people who only care about what's profitable.
But what's profitable to whom?
To the business, to the politicians with vested interest inside of other companies. And so you cannot change that.
So don't say that was profitable and stop there, because it's important to say who actually gets the profit. Because if you just say I think that's a lot of people assume that the governments do care about getting money and making money and not running a deficit and not having debt and all that sort of stuff.
I mean,
and that's not
having
the case.
A country means you have an economy, and if you have no economy,
the economy happens as a consequence of how you run the government, not as what comes before. You know what I mean? Like, if your government runs a deficit, it doesn't mean that the economy is going to be bad. In fact, it very likely means that the economy is going to be good, because the economy is not 100%, or rather, the economy and the government sort of two different things, because the government's a little bit detached. So if the government basically loans money to the economy, you can look at it a little bit like that under certain circumstances. You could say that if the government runs a deficit, the economy has more money and it does better. You know what I mean?
No, I'm not too sure about that. I think a government should always be, much like taxes, should be even. Like, you should not be in a deficit, but you should definitely not be, like, running in the profits either. Your government, the point of taxes is to facilitate the upkeep of a government. And you can you can have some money as, like, a rainy day fund, but not, like the U.S. has trillions. And like a rainy day fund. But
all
we also
governments
have
trillions.
Double trillion.
Not trillions,
deficit.
But... Yeah, and all governments have a lot of deficit and a lot of debt. But that's because that's how the economy works. Because if you don't have the investment from the government, a lot of industries just don't exist and don't...
And it seems like a lot of policies are done on the basis of not creating more deficit. And
that's because of other things. That's other aspects. That's usually because they want to get social security. They want to get the public investment to make sure that the private companies get more money.
So my thing is, the reason I say that apathy is an individual problem is because the only way to change a system is by people doing something about it. Not by the system. The system will not fix itself. The U.S. government will not, for example, will not make itself less corrupt. That's not in its nature. There's no reason. There's no purpose to do that. Now, people can do that. Which is like what we did in a previous election. We voted a not corrupt person to sit in one small part of the government. But there are hundreds of other positions in the government still filled with corrupt people that are not being taken out. And thus the corruption will continue to keep going until people stop being apathetic and remove those people that are in.
I think there's another step before the apathy goes away.
What, education?
Yeah. In a single word, yeah.
Education takes time, and time is something that clearly do not have, given how close we were to running out of it.
What I'm saying is, you could reshape your perspective of it into saying, instead of saying before, nothing is going to change unless people stop being apathetic. You could change it into, because I think it's more productive to change it into a perspective saying, nothing is going to change until people are not aware of how this works.
I don't buy the fact that people can't be aware. We live in the most interconnected time of all human history. You can find information instantly from anywhere.
But
there's no reason to
not
be informed except by apathy.
But that's why it's powerful to say that people need to be aware, because then we have power. And certainly we have a podcast,
it's
one of
true
us
to
listening.
Just say people are lazy pieces of shit and they need to get up and stop being lazy pieces of shit.
I'm saying is, you're jumping the gun. Don't give them time. Yeah,
no, I'm not going to give them time. You've had time. I've watched you have time, and no one's taken the time. Like, I've sat here and watched people.
If you have individual examples, I mean, I can't argue against.
I have family. Yeah,
I'm sure you have. I'm sure.
Friends
I'm sure.
Of
I'm
family.
Saying.
I have.
What I'm saying is,
I've seen a state. I lived in this.
There's
state,
individual
and it's
examples.
Constantly failing to do anything.
There's a lot of people who are never going to change, and that's just how it is.
Not be that way.
Well, I think our time is better spent on the people who can change. And sometimes we don't know. Sometimes Like, because the thing is, the first step is really talking about this sort of stuff. Because only, like, I said this in, like, 2 weeks ago.
Well, yeah.
Sometimes you just need to leave a seed of a thought, and people will get there.
That's why I mean by, like, apathy is also ignoring things. Like, you can just not give a shit. You can not care. And if you try talking with somebody and they go, like, I don't care about that, that's apathy.
Yeah, yeah.
Like... And that's what I mean is, like, so if you want to educate someone, first they have to want to be educated.
Sometimes you just need a seed. Sometimes you just need to
say
a thought or say your opinions, point something out.
How many times do you do that until you give up on that person being a contributing member of society?
I mean,
like, I have had 30 years with my family and I cannot convince them, no matter how many seeds, no matter how many explanations, no matter how many times I've just literally point blank done the conspiracy theory pat on the wall, like, you fucking morons can see you're losing money every year by the decisions you make, but you continue to make them. Why do you do that? And they go, well, the other guys, what? You will not show me anything. You just say that. You do not want to learn. You do not want to get better. You just want to feel like you're winning. That's it. There's a weird sense of, like, emotions tied to decisions, and that is a stupid, fucking, ignorant way to live your life. I don't care about how you feel. How you feel is almost highly irrelevant to any decision made in the entirety of history. What matters is what is better for everyone involved. What matters is what makes a better world. What matters is what progresses things.
But like, you think people don't... Like, if you put it like that...
I don't want people working at service level jobs. I don't want to see someone behind the counter of a fucking McDonald's. I don't want you there. You're wasted. What a fucking absolute disgusting waste of human life.
I, like, don't think that's a good attitude to have. Because if they're okay with that job, then why are they wasting their life?
Because they don't have any other options.
I mean,
I've met people that worked at Walgreens since they were like 20. And I asked them, why are you here? You're like 80 years old. What the fuck did you just waste your life
my
for?
Question,
and
my
they
question
go like,
is,
well, I didn't have anything else I was good at. Probably because you didn't have time to find something else you were good
okay
at.
What if they're okay with that job, though?
What?
What I mean is, like, if you see somebody who works their entire life away in a factory,
mm-hmm.
and goes home every day and just that's their life. If they're mm-hmm. happy with that, why is that a wasted life? I'm asking you, like, it's not a rhetorical question. Why, I'm trying to understand why you said what you said.
Because there are a multitude of things that people could be doing with their time that they may just not be aware they are good at doing. Working at a factory is not what they're good at doing. No matter if they like it or not. It is not something
that
they're
like
good
at. But they like it. Do you know what I mean?
I don't care if they like it. It's not useful.
But they care.
I don't care what they care about. I care about what is useful for the entirety, the whole of the race, not the individual. The individual is nothing. They're minuscule. They are something that can be replaced instantly. They're not relevant here. Their feelings.
I think you're not putting your words into context of your own reality. I think because the thing you're saying that, but
people
that can be said about literally anybody.
So people can have the world can be a more enjoyable and pleasant place the less selfish people are. For example, a person who likes to go to a factory every day and work at a factory is baffling and confusing. But you can take that ridiculously stupid emotion and convert it into creating robots that do that job that you enjoy doing. You can teach them how to do that job because you are good or you enjoy doing it, and you can show them how to do that job. And that is the way that you can take a worthless emotion and turn it into something productive.
The thing is, that's a fundamental different job. Like, that's not what they like doing. If they make tables.
If they like making tables, they can explain why they like making tables to someone who will
then
automate that job for them.
They don't like making robots. Or they don't like teaching. Because the thing, what I'm saying is...
Well, they don't have to like teaching. They just, if they like doing their job, they just need to show somebody who's going to make a robot to replace them how to do that job efficiently. Because they like it so much, they can show them all the ins and outs, right? And then once they're done, you can get rid of them. And now you replace them with a robot. And
you're The thing is, what you're saying can be applied to anybody, literally any job.
Yes.
It's not even any job. It's any activity.
No, not any activity.
Okay, give me an example.
Most creative things are hard to automate because they.
Well, that doesn't mean they can't be automated.
And
that doesn't mean they're not profitable to somebody else, and you're not just like hogging the machine.
Can't be automated. It's just that there isn't much incentive. There's not really much reason to, because you can't get. You won't get what you want out of automating creative ventures.
Go ahead.
No, I was gonna say because a lot of the thing is that people are more drawn to, when it comes to creative stuff, people are more drawn to things that are with creative stuff. There's not a mathematical equation to create. Successful or inspiring piece of art. It's something that just happens.
Yeah, whereas, I was just saying that the argument itself can be used, but there's other caveats.
Yeah, creating a chair, a hamburger, creating life, all of these things are easy.
It's not easy. It's very difficult. What? There's a lot of jobs that are very difficult. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter because the people are good at it. They have an easy time with it, whatever the job is. Even if it's difficult for somebody else, it's easy.
And again, that's fine. You can have a person sitting in a factory and working until they die.
What I think you're hanging on to is that that person is a cog in a machine, that they're disposable, and the people up top don't care about them. But I think that happens to everybody.
It can if you work at a job that is just a cog in a machine. Which is why I would rather just replace the cog with an actual machine.
But it happens to us as well, who are on YouTube.
Sure. Yeah, sure. It could happen. Yeah, bots can make videos for children, and children watch it more than the content made by actual humans.
But even if it isn't about a bot, it's just that we are cogs in a machine. But that doesn't mean that our cog is not worth enjoying, because it is our enjoyment. It is, and especially if it's something.
Sure.
I don't care.
I only care about what makes things go forward, what progresses.
But that's very high level, though. You can never discard. Yeah, you can never, like, the thing. Imagine we lived all sort of like. Imagine how humans were 2,000 years ago, living in small villages and maybe isolated families and all that sort of stuff. And
very,
there were a lot of people.
Boring life, yes.
But it wasn't boring.
It wasn't boring.
Why would it be boring? Didn't you have art just the same way? Didn't you have family and friends?
Yeah, but you didn't have access to seeing hundreds and millions and trillions of it every day.
But that's a value that you have that isn't even shared by everybody today, let alone back then.
Seems incredibly boring. You just do the same thing.
I'm not saying that you don't find it boring.
Like,
I'm just saying that the people didn't necessarily find it boring. Like, there's bored people at any moment in time. And it doesn't have to do with technology. It has to do with just
Their
lives.
So art, the only art you would see in a small village is like the art in your small village, unless you leave your small village to go to a different village to go look at their art. If you did so, you're putting yourself at risk because there's, you know, like someone could rob you on the way. There's somebody who could,
die
of disease,
so,
and you're
not
going to get
a
doctor in
time. So many possibilities.
Yeah, it's what a shitty life. I don't want to live that. Right now, I could sit on this computer while we're talking, recording a podcast that will be sent to people. I can look up hundreds of different art.
I'm not saying you want to live there. I'm saying the people who lived back then have the same attitude towards their daily life as any person who lives right now has the same attitude towards their daily life. Because
sorry
what matters to us... Sorry?
I'm sorry for their loss.
Well, but that happens to anybody. Like, imagine somebody who just doesn't care about this sort of conversation. For us, it's enjoyable, but some people are just, they would check out. If you would talk to them about this, they check out. But maybe if you just give them, hey, do you want to make a puzzle? And they make a puzzle with you for the whole afternoon. Or maybe they want to, I don't know, sing or paint or ride a motorcycle. Like, there's so many different... What I'm trying to say is that being passionate about something shouldn't blind you to the passion of others. And it's very easy for us to be passionate about how amazing it is to discover human intellect throughout our history. Me as having a background in history, I certainly feel that, and that's part of why I went into history. But it's very easy for us to be marveled at finding a human intellect, and that's in art, that's in other opinions, that's in discussions, all that. But there's also a lot of passion for just, making a nice chair, or playing the guitar, or acting, or singing very well, or having kids, or having a garden. Driving a car. You know, there's people have such different priorities that I don't think it's.
So what if we were in a place where you could just do that? What if you could just do the thing that you wanted to do, that you enjoy doing? You know, obviously within the like constraints of like not impeding other people's enjoyment. But like, if you enjoy making a chair, what if you could live in a society where you could just make a fucking chair all day, every day, 9 to 5, make a chair? Like, you could just do that. Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah, that's called. Yeah, that the system doesn't allow for that though. I mean, maybe making the chair.
You need to stop caring
allows.
About other people's individual and get to a point where everything is at a point where we progress to far enough of a level where people can just do whatever the hell they want all day, every day, and it doesn't impact or change the world. Like, you need to get to a point where the world is so self-sustainable that people can just be selfish and do their little thing and be apathetic and enjoy their stupid garbage chair making, and it doesn't impede.
To work before we even start going there, though.
I agree.
It's what I said.
Feelings about stuff and move towards a future.
We need to stop people killing each other. We need to stop people gaining money from people killing each other.
But why do people do that?
Because of the money. Because of the profit. It's the reason why the police hunts down
mental illness and unemployment and societal pressures and a lot of this stuff that could be just replaced by not obligating people to work in shitty jobs every fucking day to make ends meet so they can survive in what amounts to like the shittiest fucking roguelike game I've ever seen in reality.
Ask why they are obligated to work in those conditions. Because of profit.
So then again, just stop caring about that. And
how do you stop? The problem isn't the people who work that care about profit. It's the people who employ them that care about profit. This is why what I've been saying all along. It's not about the ones below. It's the ones on top. They're the ones that make the decisions.
And the ones
to
up
profit.
Top aren't there. Are only there because the ones below put them there.
Nah, they're there because they know how to exploit the system. They know how to make profit. Or they lucked into that as well.
I'm pretty sure the person who's the mayor in my town was voted in to be the fucking mayor in my town.
But that's
he
not
makes
the
more
one
money
on top,
than
though.
I do, even though I'm living in an apartment that costs way too much.
The owners of the banks, the owners of the companies, they're the ones on top. They're the ones making the money.
And who allows them to be in that position? The people that have been elected into their positions.
The people who are elected into their positions are paid by them. You know that, right? It's called campaign contributions and other things, and lobbying in general.
And if you didn't have apathy, you would see that because you could look up how much candidates are generating in campaign finances. And you can go, hey, this one's only generated from grassroots efforts. This one hasn't. I'll vote for the one with grassroots efforts.
Well, sometimes it's not about apathy, though. It's about because some people will see adverts on television or on Facebook about how those people are demonic pedophiles.
And that's the worst. That's the most you're going to do in researching. You're just going to go like, well, the TV told me.
But you can't just go for you can't say that it's apathy because it isn't. It's. No, talking about this sort of
stuff. Sorry, that's ignorance. That's just plain moronic ignorance, and you're again just as worthless as somebody who's apathetic. Like,
well, you're contributing to the system, so you're absolutely it's definitely worse than apathy.
So change if you want things to change, you have to do it. You can't just sit there and go like, well, someone else will take care of it. No, they won't. They literally will not because you have to do it. It always has to be you. Like, that's the thing. And if you want to go like, well, that's too much work, or I don't have time to do that, or blah, blah, blah. Those are just excuses to be apathetic, or those are excuses to be ignorant. Like, and again, you're welcome to. I don't care what you do, but your value is less. like, because you do that. And like, when bad things happen to you, I care less and less about the bad things happening to you because of your apathy. Like, I put in the effort, so I don't have to care about those who don't, because I put in that effort.
Let's bring the example back to climate change. What power do people have?
Voting in politicians who will enact policy that will punish those who do or who cause higher rates of carbon pollution.
Yeah.
So why don't you vote a bunch of people in who are going to bring a Green New Deal, bring a whole bunch of jobs into different sectors for renewable energy.
Where were those people in the ballot?
They were there. They were absolutely there.
They were?
Yes.
No, they weren't.
Many of them lost their primaries. Because a lot of them just got reelected.
Oh, you think they're going to bring the Green New Deal? Okay. Well, I guess
they're the ones who are voting yes to it. The ones who are voting no to it are the ones who, some of them got reelected.
I'm not saying that, you know, of course, some of them are absolutely opposed to it. What I'm saying is, if you think the Democratic Party is going to bring the Green New Deal, I don't know. I don't think.
I didn't say that. I said there are candidates who are progressive in their beliefs on the Green New Deal. It doesn't matter what party lines you want. Again, a party line, Republican or Democrat, doesn't fucking mean anything. It's like a football team. It's meaningless. All that matters is the policy that they enable. If a Republican came out and said, "I want to do the Green New Deal," great, I would vote for that. I don't care what party he's aligned with. I care about his policy. If he goes, "I want to do Green New Deal, but I also want to make it so that like Fortune 500 companies can exploit workers," well then shit, no man, that's bad policy. I'm not going to vote for you. I'm going to ask the other candidate, "Hey, do you support the Green New Deal and not exploiting workers?" And if they go no, it's like, well shit, I guess I don't support either of these candidates. Got to find a different candidate.
And what if you're not even in the U.S.? Because that's the thing, especially in climate change.
If you're not in the U.S., vast majority you've probably got a country with your own set of problems that you need to deal with. But the
U.S. controls so much of the world economy. And it's also the biggest polluter.
Then start electing people who are going to kick out United States from having bases in their country.
True.
Because that's how we exert dominance. We are just exerting pressure in other countries by having military bases there. So kick us out. Other countries they fucking just boot us out. And then what do? We just go home. We are a dog with no bite. Unless you have oil, we won't fucking do anything to you. We're mostly just going to sit back and go like, well,
that's,
I mean, they're not
going
to stop
true.
Us.
That's not quite true. Republica Dominicana didn't have oil, and you still overthrew the government because they were going to be communists. And no,
well,
was
okay,
it Panama?
You can't, I mean, not the 50s. We're not talking about the 50s. You can't, looking at the, like, that was a different time. Right now, absolutely, right now. If anybody that's not in the Middle East, any country that is not in the Middle East, kicks us out, we won't do anything
right now,
to you. We will not do anything to you. We will just look at you very upset and go, oh, the damn, I can't believe Brazil kicked us out. But we're not going to invade Brazil. Like, no, we're just going to like walk away.
It's really interesting to think that right now in the world of today, a country going full-on communist would be zero threat to the United States, which it wasn't back in the 50s.
China is still a communist country.
It's not communist. It's state capitalism.
Their name is literally communist.
The North Korea says the People's Republic of Democratic Republic
of
something.
They're also communist. But we don't stop them because
they're not
communist.
They're state capitalists. They're driven by profit, just like
Russia.
Anybody
also wasn't communist.
No, it wasn't. Yeah.
So and we stopped them. Why? Because they wanted the oil we wanted in the Middle East.
Yeah, but the
they also had nukes, and we didn't like that because we were the only ones that should have had nukes. We didn't want them, and they had a bunch of uranium in Russia, and we wanted that uranium. Like, again, America is selfish and in their goals. They don't care about a lot of stuff. But people let them get away with it because people are like, oh, fuck, it's America. Just squirt the country with a water bottle. We'll go away. We're not very stern. Like, we're a country that folds under pressure.
I'm not sure that's the case. Like, you're still in
Afghanistan. Have you seen Vietnam? Vietnam was like a perfect example.
How long was the war? Like 20 years?
No, I don't think Vietnam was 20 years.
I thought it was like a lot. I don't even know what the war is called.
55 to 75. So I guess it was 20 years. 20 years. 20 years.
I mean, I don't think water bottle squirting is a good...
Well, okay, and again, that's a...
It's very long time ago, for sure, but like...
But it, no one else...
The
no
same
one else...
people, the same people and the same methods that but made
no,
Vietnam
no one else
the
did anything about it.
What do you mean, no one else? It was like there were manifestations in the U.S. and throughout the world against the war.
Oh, sure, but no one stopped us. No one walked up and said, like, hey, get the fuck out of here or
how
else.
How could you
like,
stop it, though?
I don't know. You have what? Oh, you have, like, UK, France, Germany, Japan, China.
No, you're talking about people. Korea, how could the people have... stop? How could
people elect politicians that are going to have stern relations in foreign policy and do things that prevent, like, America from just showing up at someone's front door and starting an ancient long war? Like, you can do that. You know what? You know how you stop that? It's called embargo or trade.
Yeah,
trade
let's think
disputes.
Of a. Let's
like,
think of a so an example where
example.
That worked.
What does the United States produce that the rest of the world needs?
IT.
No. We don't make. So we develop phones, but we don't make them here. China makes those phones.
Well, but that's the thing. It's not China.
So, we don't make anything here that the world needs. If you guys made, if you guys put a trade embargo where everybody else has to charge us like $50-$100 extra to trade with us, we'd be fucked. We'd be super fucked. We'd be so beyond fucked. We'd be fucked beyond fucked. Like just, and you could do that. The UN and China could just be like, yeah, no, fuck you. We're not going to trade with you anymore. And we'd be screwed. We'd be like, well, we got agriculture. Yeah, good luck, everyone. We've got oil and cows. Like, we're not going to get technology anymore. We're not going to get, like, we would have a hard time restructuring our entire economy around rebuilding factories in this country.
But you're forgetting.
And we'd struggle with getting, like, rubber and minerals and iron. Like, we would have such a fucking hard time.
You're forgetting the problem, though. Profit. Who has the money in the United States? And where would that money go?
Again, that's not. But again, that's in the United States.
Rich people
aren't allegiant to the country. They'll leave a country that's not profitable.
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. So other countries could be like, "Yeah, come on over here, rich people. We're not embargoing."
So what happens when you embargo the United States in a situation in a catastrophic world-ending situation like that? What would be the result? The companies
you'd probably cripple the American economy.
The American people.
Yeah.
But not the companies. So
you'd make us suffer the crimes that we've made other people suffer for.
Solve anything, though.
Sure you would.
You wouldn't, because the American people are not the ones responsible. It's the ones in charge. And the ones in charge would get scot-free.
We elect those people. The American people actively elected Donald Trump as a president. We gave that to you on purpose.
The politicians don't matter.
Okay, I think we're really just repeating in loops at this point, like several times.
Okay. I don't know. The point I'm making is that, like, it's every individual is important to every decision. You like when you if you're in a democratic country where you can vote on things, because I know there are some of you who can't. If you can vote like Americans can, then it is absolutely the individual's decision on who gets into positions of power and who stays in those positions of power. You can go to your family and friends and teach them about voting differently. You can also vote differently on yourself, or you can just bring a fucking guillotine to their front yard and go, if you come out of this fucking house to vote on a bad thing, I'll cut your fucking head off. Like, there are millions of ways you can go through dealing with different choices to prevent people in power from not doing bad decisions. But it's easier to not do anything and go, oh man, it's the people above just running the puppet strings. Can't do anything about the Soros, big old government things, whatever, conspiracy bullshit. And then you just like let this happen continually. And it like, I don't know. Why do we have gerrymandering in a country where we could just elect people to get rid of it? Because no one does that.
I will just like to raise the counterpoint of apartheid in South Africa lasted from 1968 to 1992, I think it was. That was like 35 years. And it was a much more Well, as horrible as it was, obviously, it was a much more localized thing, and it was much less impactful in the whole world. And the whole world stood together, or not the whole world, but many people around the world stood together and to boycott South Africa and to make change happen. I remember I was a kid, but I remember my dad talking about it because it was big news right around. I was six or five or at the time. But yeah, it worked. And Portugal had a similar situation with Timor in 2004 or 2003, because Indonesia was basically genociding the Timorese people. And they were an ex-colony of Portugal. And it was like a lot of pressure from here in Portugal, but also from people in the East, in East Asia. And it, like, things can change. But you're painting a rosy, such a rosy picture that I think ignores precedent. You know what I mean?
I'm looking at it very negatively. I don't believe that things will change. I do not believe people will make change happen. People are too worthless to do that. I just believe that people have the power to make it change. If people want change to happen, they have all the power to do it, but they won't. And that's why things are as bad as they are. I don't believe that no one has more power over other people than other people. Like, yeah, like everyone's just human. And humans are not invincible. So it just requires if you don't like something, you collaborate with other people who don't like something and overthrow that problem. And if you can't, then you just get more people and you keep getting more people. And eventually you have more people than the people that are in power. And then you just overthrow them, which is how almost every revolution happens.
Yeah, I think that was my point.
Yeah, and so I agree, but my stance is people will make that happen.
We're just having different perspectives. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't believe it will ever happen, and you believe that it's possible.
But I think a decent number of these debates that happen towards the end of the episodes are you guys agreeing on things but then like arguing about the semantics of how to phrase it or how to look at it or something?
It's more we're disagreeing on policy. We're disagreeing on the way
at some point.
We're disagreeing on the way to go about the change. Usually I agree that change can happen. And I agree that change is something that, needs to happen, but I don't believe that it can happen because the people won't do it.
And some of these, I'm like, oh, okay, they're having this conversation. I get where this is going. They'll tucker themselves out. And then like 90 minutes pass. I'm like, oh fuck, what have I done?
Yeah, I mean,
I just
but that's
sat
the
here
thing,
waiting.
Like,
I'm like, no, they're never gonna. We should. They're never gonna run out of energy. They have infinite energy.
You should have talked about YouTube.
You guys have this like fucking the most clean burning coal engine of all time, and it just keeps getting shoveled. And I'm like, oh fuck, this could go on for 5 hours. I genuinely thought like I could have just left and cooked dinner, and come back and eaten it, and I would have finished before you guys ever ran out of energy to keep going.
Possibly. But
we need your counterpoint, Keith, to
I didn't really have any strong counterpoint or like a side to take here. Especially since I could kind of tell that you guys were basically agreeing anyway, but having really fine disagreements about really almost difficult to express nuances about what was even the difference. And some of it's some of it as I'm just too used to Andrew. I've just known Andrew for so long, and I know the conversation patterns, and so there's specific avenues that I know not to encourage, because it'll be like, okay, yeah, I know where that'll go, and it'll go for a long, long time.
It would just be so much easier.
But you're new.
I'm new. I don't know the traps.
You're young. You haven't been worn down. So you're like, oh yeah, I'll debate Andrew about the state of the world for like 2 hours. Like, oh no.
All that matters is
like, I always remember the time that we watched Tokyo Godfathers, and then Joe and I ended up arguing with Andrew about whether or not existence is real or something for like 2 hours. It felt like No matter how backed into a corner Andrew got, it was just an infinite conversation. And we were never going to go anywhere, and we were definitely starting to just loop at some point. And I'm like, oh no.
Can I know what Andrew took? What side Andrew took in that existence is real argument?
Eventually he started saying sentences like, I can't know if I know anything. Things like that. And I'm like, okay, I hate this entire conversation. I want out.
The idea is if existence doesn't exist, then how the fuck would I know existence doesn't exist? Because I exist in existence, so therefore I perceive existence to exist. It got so word-soupy
and infuriating that I'm like, I regret ever engaging with this. Like, why have I done this?
There's like stuff I just don't think about because it's not worth the time. I would just it's like Pinky and the Brain style where like Andrew. Pinky just says a stupid shit. Like if I was an ostrich, how would I use the bathroom? Would I bend my legs front or backwards?
Andrew,
like,
one of these days.
What the fuck kind of question is that? Like, who gives a shit? Just move on with life. Like,
one of these days, you and me should do a solo podcast. I say solo, but you know, without Keith, because he's gonna just boil. If we talk about this, we should talk about this.
If you guys want to have a second weekly podcast on your own, be my guest.
My only fucking thing is,
you've got the time.
if you can, just elect people to make MySpace again. That's all I fucking care about. Just make another MySpace. God damn. Like, I just hate how social media looks. Make it beautiful again. Fuck, man. HTML
it's
is
not
so
beautiful. It's ugly.
HTML has expanded so much in like 5 years, and no it one has really. Done anything with. Yes, it had bullshit. You can embed videos now inside of HTML. That's a
you
whole,
could always do that.
Could you, no, no. You
I've been doing
that,
do that for 15 years.
No, you could not. You had to use JavaScript prior. Do not lie. You
no
could
JavaScript
embed,
is HTML.
No, what? No, JavaScript is its own language outside of HTML, and you had to use JavaScript. You had to use a JavaScript plugin to add video to HTML. Now, HTML5 or HTML6 has native video.
HTML5 already had that.
Okay, yeah, but HTML5 again is only 5 years old. MySpace was like
no,
10
it's
years
not.
Old.
Is that why it's called HTML5?
This is too technical, but it isn't. It's older. HTML5 is like from the 19.
Next year does it become HTML6?
No, HTML5 is not from the 1990s.
No, no, I'm sorry. It's from 2007 or something like that. The initial release is 2014, but the video is from 2009 or something like that. Because there's parts of it that come out.
But in any case, the world did not support HTML5 natively. Not all browsers supported HTML5 natively.
That's the biggest problem.
Now that we have way better HTML, we need a way better version of MySpace that supports HTML in the same way. Because I want to be able to have an entire fucking profile page with nothing but Nickelback videos going, look at this graph.
My browser kept asking me permission to disable Flash. And then one time I finally accidentally clicked on yes, and now Flash is disabled on every website. I'm like, gee, this is so fucking annoying.
I haven't used Flash in forever.
Google if it can be turned back on or anything.
Yeah, you can go inside of, you can go to your browser settings.
You think
settings.
You could just fucking click on a giant empty Flash window and be like, yo, browser, I want it. Load it, asshole. But it's like, no, I gotta go back end and fix something.
No, if you go on a web page that has Flash and it's not loading, at the address bar on the far left of the right to the left of the address bar, there's like a little lock symbol. If you click that, it gives you the option for site permissions. And in that site permissions, you can say, oh, I want to allow Adobe Flash. That's how you can do that.
I think they stopped using that. I haven't used Flash. Vivaldi doesn't support Flash. So I haven't used Flash since I switched to Vivaldi.
A lot of websites have stopped supporting Flash because it's a risky platform.
Because it's discontinued,
Anyways, it doesn't matter. The point is that I think it's atrocious that we're not allowed to express ourselves freely on social media websites except via pictures, which are the worst way to do any expression.
And GIFs.
GIFs are also the worst way to express anything.
I like GIFs.
Because a lot of the best memes are always my favorite on Twitter is when someone's like, oh, I can't figure out how to fit these two into my profile header. And then they make a tweet like, oh, I figured it out. And you have to go to their profile to figure out how they changed their header. And then that's great. It's personable. You go there and you're like, oh, man. And if it's funny enough, you would click follow. And it encourages people to go and view people's profiles. And that's what you should be doing all along, because social media isn't about a senseless void. It's about the connections of those people in the senseless void. And you should be going to people's profiles and connecting with them there and seeing their updates personally like you would check the news. But you don't. You look at an endless feed and it's inhuman and devoid of feeling and emotion. And I hate it. And I miss MySpace. I just want to go back to the days.
How the hell do we wind up like this?
Exactly.
I think that's a good point to end the
call back to the same Nickelback podcast song, but it was the theme of the episode. Plot twist.
Yeah, fair enough.
All right. Send your questions into Dialog Choices Podcast. Or Dialog... Fuck.
That's not how it is.
Let
me open it.
Dialog Choices... It's dialogchoicespodcast@gmail.com. I had to remember if it was questions or not. But it's Dialog Choices Podcast. And send in questions, and I can use them to bat them away when they start going on a 90-minute debate.
That'll, or so you think.
I'll
send your debate questions to...
I might try to moderate more proactively in the future. I don't know. We'll see how people like this episode.
Well, I guess...
I like the part where they argued about the state of the world for a long time.
It's relatable because I'm in the state of the world for a long time.
All right. See you guys next time.
Bye. Bye.